usually finishes all of those. I think he's a little tired.
Alexander, what a move. Misses Green!
I mean, he's the guy, let him shoot it, but if he's going to shoot it, okay. And then Green with the great follow-up there.
As I told the team, epic game. Not sure I've been part of one quite like it in 35 years. And obviously, Oregon is, they've had a hell of a year. What Dana's done to navigate all the injuries and get the team to this point where, you know, they're a point away from advancing into the Sweet 16. I mean, it was anybody's game. And, you know, Baylor made two veteran plays at the end of regulation. You know, recognizing in transition down four, just get downhill, put your head down. Then we executed the press and got it in the guys' hands we wanted it to be, and we got the foul right away. And you know, Baylor works on that little floater mid fadeaway all the time, and he knocks it down to get it to overtime. And then to regroup after the big shot that Cousinard hit, you know, that was a tough shot. Baylor was right there to tie it at 71, to regroup and get ourselves ready for the second overtime. Really proud of our guys. They've stuck with each other all year, and, you know, these four have been a rock. They've been absolutely a joy to coach. They don't care who gets the credit. They share the basketball. They play in an unselfish way. And then I can't say enough about Jason Green and his impact on the game. You know, he wasn't playing a lot coming off an injury that he had. But he stayed ready, and he kept working. And whether whether he was on the scout team or playing a little off the bench, he was always willing to do whatever he had to do to help the team. So I couldn't be more proud of him and the impact that he had in this game. He deserved a night like this for how selfless he's been and how and his approach to this team.
That's Greg McDermott. And Creighton moving on after beating Oregon. What a weekend. Glad you're with us once more, Joe Franklin. It is Out of Bounds. Joe, so many games, so many highlights, so many it just gets all lost in my mind. I don't remember when the Creighton-Oregon game was. It's just a basketball overload. It's a buffet of basketball, and it's just all mushing together, you know, after you've started that buffet and then towards the end of it, you know, your peas and carrots and your green beans, everything's just running together.
Not sure a lot of people get to the peas and carrots of a buffet of basketball over the weekend, but starting Thursday and Friday, we know those are the games that everybody looks forward to, and you have so many games. Yeah, by the time you get to Saturday and Sunday, you kind of pick and choose from there, and it's not just sit down and appointment TV.
The one I remember the best is, I guess, the last one I watched last night, and that was Texas A&M in Houston. What a game. What a comeback by the Aggies late. Just a fanatic pace, right? Not fanatic pace, but just a crazy pace at the end of the game for A&M to come all the way back. And some of the plays that Buzz Williams drew up, out-of-bounds plays, I mean, he had one draw up, wide open, easy layup, and then the three at the end of the game, you know, with 1-point-something seconds left, wide open three, top of the key, knocks it down and goes to overtime. Man, that was a fun finish. And I had gone on my Bet Saracen account and had Aggies plus 9.5, and at the half, I felt even better about the Aggies, so I put a little extra on them. And then I look up, they're down like 12 towards the end of the game. I'm like, well, that was stupid. And here come the Aggies, and makes it a double winner for me. I love the way that game finished and the way the Aggies play. But I felt good about A&M because, you know, the knock on Houston here recently has been rebounding. They've been allowing teams to get a lot of offensive rebounds. That's what A&M does. They pound the glass. And so I felt like A&M was going to have a chance to win that game. So I was kind of disappointed it wasn't closer until the very end of the game.
It was great to get it to overtime. They did what they needed to down the stretch. But once they got there, then you saw Houston and being that number one seed and how talented they are, they took over in overtime. And it really wasn't much of a game once you got to overtime.
Yeah. Which was incredible because Houston had so many guys foul out, you know, some important guys, and they just kept clicking. They are so well coached. defensively, you see how they get after you and how they move as a team on the defensive side of the ball. And then offensively, they run their offense and get great quality looks, and then they knock down those shots. Yeah, it's easy to see why they're one of the top four seeds watching them play. They're like a machine out there, it just clicks.
When they got to overtime, also, it was A&M would get close enough, and then Houston would hit a key bucket every time. So they never let A&M get to where they felt like they had a chance to win the game in overtime. They would always hit a key bucket or go to the free throw line, knock down some free throws, and extend that lead.
Yeah, last game last night, that was the San Diego State game. And they were ahead so much, I didn't even turn that on.
San Diego State, Yale.
Yeah, that was a yawner. We had a lot of that yesterday. Yesterday afternoon, because Saturday was awesome. There were so many good games Saturday, and then Sunday was just blowout after blowout after blowout until we had that Houston game. It just seemed like – and then Saturday – but Saturday was just fantastic. It was just great basketball played all day long. And so yesterday was kind of a disappointment because it didn't live up to the drama that we had on Saturday with all the early blowouts, at least on CBS. But you look at it, and we had so many upsets early on, and now you look at the bracket, and it's – besides North Carolina State, if you want to throw Clemson in there as a sixth seed, everybody else is, you know, probably should be there. It's not a surprise that they're there.
That NC State-Oakland game was pretty good also.
Yeah. Yeah.
But NC State was able to go ahead and take control of that one. And we're talking about two double-digit seeded teams that were going head-to-head. So a lot of brackets were messed up because of those two teams playing each other.
But if North Carolina State knocks off Marquette, you're fine. You're going to be fine because so many people either had Kentucky or Marquette right there. Very few people will have North Carolina State, so you're not going to lose out a whole lot unless, you know, of course, you had Kentucky in the finals or winning the whole thing. But if you just had them going to the Final Four even, if they knock off – if one of these teams knocks off Houston, you're going to be okay. It's not going to kill you in your bracket. But for the most part, I bet everybody's brackets look okay. I bet I have one of the worst brackets out there. I only have 7 of the 16 teams left. It's the worst I've ever done. My bracket is just terrible. I picked some upsets. The upsets didn't happen. And then some of the upsets that did happen, like a Clemson or North Carolina State, I obviously didn't pick them. Part of my problem was thinking the SEC was going to do better than they did. And right now, the SEC with Tennessee and Alabama, that's it. I would have thought there were more. If we would have had a poll question, I believe a lot of people would have thought. Out of the 8 teams that made it, I would have said at least half make it to the Sweet 16. Because I definitely thought Kentucky, definitely thought Auburn. So that's 4 right there.
Yeah, the SEC may have been – it looked really competitive all season, and you had some of those better teams, but overall, when you get to the tournament, and sometimes you get a false narrative one way or another, it could be a false narrative in the regular season that these teams look a lot better than they are, or you get to the tournament and then these teams look better than they have during the regular season. And so in this case, it's looking like the SEC may not have been as good as everybody thought they were.
I read a great story, and it was taking a deeper dive into the SEC and the issues that the SEC was having this year, and they felt like the officiating in the SEC was part of the problem, that in SEC games, they call the games so tight that teams get used to going to the free throw line, kind of like Arkansas, and using the free throw line as part of their advantage. You have seen very few games this year in the NCAA tournament where they called it super tight. Last night, the Houston A&M game was one of the few games I've watched that I felt like, come on, you're blowing your whistle way too much. You're calling everything. You got to let them play a little bit. For the most part, I would say about 95% of the games I've watched, they let them play. That wasn't the case in the SEC. Very rarely did you see an SEC game where they just let them play and didn't call a lot of fouls. And the SEC kind of got used to that blueprint, and it worked in previous years for Arkansas. You even saw Arkansas in the tournament go into the free throw line a lot. And I don't know if something has changed across the nation to where they're letting them play more. I know in the Big 12, I watched a lot of Big 12 basketball this year. They let them play. It is night and day watching a Big 12 game officiated than watching an SEC game officiated. What they let go by in the Big 12, it's crazy, Joe. In the SEC, you touch them, it's a foul. Big 12, you got to knock them to the ground. Before, it's like old school NBA. And that's kind of carried over into the NCAA tournament. And this story was kind of indicating that part of the problem could have been just the way they played in the SEC and how the games were officiated in the SEC.
Well, the thought was that it was going to be officiated the same way once the tournament started, but it hasn't been that way. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, that could have an effect on you. But teams, when they get to the tournament and they see how these games are officiated, whether we're talking about the tournament as a whole or an individual game, you have to be able to adjust game to game. And you get a feel for how the game is being called, get a feel for the officials and the crew there, and you have to be able to adjust if it's not what you're used to.
Don't you hate Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday now? Without the games for 3 days, it's like, oh, my, what do we do now? There's no basketball.
Yeah, it'd be all right.
You got women.
Find something to
watch. Yeah, you watch the women. The other half of their field will move on to the Sweet 16 tonight, so you have some good women's games. I know Hyatt was playing, so that's something you can watch on TV. But we'll have to wait until Thursday for these Sweet 16 games. UConn, San Diego State, Illinois, Iowa State. That East is pretty much chalk. San Diego State a 5. North Carolina, Alabama, 1-4, 6-2. Clemson, Arizona. Clemson, the one not chalk. Houston and Duke, what a matchup there. That'll be on the 29th. North Carolina State, the 11, taking on Marquette. Purdue, Gonzaga, great game, 1-5. And then another chalk, 2-3, Tennessee, Creighton. That's on the 29th also. So, yeah, I think that's 8 really good games that it's going to see a lot of action. Bet Saracen app. We'll see a lot of action, that's for sure.
So, yeah, it is dwindling down now. So, Thursday, Friday, we'll have 4 games. And then when we get to Saturday, Sunday, it'll be 2 games. And, of course, that next weekend, we're talking Final Four.
After the first weekend of games, seeing these teams play, if you had a do-over, who would you pick to win it?
Probably UConn. Yeah. It would go with the favorite that's there, and they look really impressive. A lot of times, and especially – with them being the current champion, a lot of times you think it's hard to repeat and keep up the same type of energy, same pace, but they've seemed to come back with the same energy from last year. Even though they lost some players in the mix, they seem to have not dropped off any.
I think I'd definitely go with UConn out of the East. That Houston-Duke game, I could see Duke beating Houston. As impressive as Houston was last night, I could see Duke winning that game. Purdue looks good. I mean, we knew Edie was good, but the offense, the help that he's been getting, that's been a big plus for them. But look, Gonzaga, how about another Sweet 16 for Gonzaga? That's an incredible story. But I still like Tennessee, but they got their hands full with Creighton. And then out of the West – I'm not a North Carolina fan. I'm not sold on them. I think Alabama – what impressed me the most was the defense Alabama played for once. They got after it on the defensive end against Grand Canyon. Low-scoring game. Those teams got after each other defensively. And so that was made me feel a little better about Alabama, my pick of Alabama, because they did play defense and won the game. Honestly, because of their defense. I would say it was their defense that got them passed because they didn't shoot the ball very good against Grand Canyon.
They do have a lot of experience from that team that went to the championship game. Mm-hmm. So that's one thing that they have on their side.
All right, well, let's take some phone calls. 661-1037, 661-1037. We got Kendall Diggs coming up at the bottom of the hour, so we'll talk some Diamond Hogs with him. They take 2 of 3 from Auburn. It's you win the series against the ranked team on the road. You got to be happy with that, but they were so close to getting a sweep. Up 5-1, 6-2. I thought they had it. And then the bullpen just didn't get the job done on Saturday afternoon. I like the Thursday games because it gives me something to do on Thursday night, but then I sure do miss it on Sunday because I'm like, I'd like to see some baseball today, but the Diamond Hogs weren't playing. But it's another Thursday, Friday, Saturday series this weekend with LSU coming to town, a top 10 matchup with the Tigers.
Doing that a lot sooner in the season and then doing them back-to-back like that.
What a sports weekend we have this weekend. I mean, with Arkansas, LSU on the diamond, top 10 matchup. You have the Arkansas Derby Saturday, and then you got the NCAA tournament to find out who's going on to the Final Four Saturday and Sunday.
Yeah. Yeah, it'll be a good weekend recap as it is today.
Yeah. Let's go to Brent. He's in Searcy. Brent, welcome in to Out of Bounds.
Yes, sir. Wes.
Yeah.
Yo, what's going on?
Hey, Brent.
Hey, long time no talk.
Yes, it has been.
Joe, I've been thinking about you. Wes, I've been thinking about you. I got a couple things that are on my mind today. And I hope I'm just going to go ahead and get them off, okay?
Okay. We're here for you.
But I just want to know how in his right mind has Hunter Yurecek not replaced Mike Nabers yet?
You waiting for an answer?
Yes, I want to know.
I believe – he's got another year, and partly it's because of the season ticket sales and the interest that they have in the program. And in years past, they would have a bad year and no one would care. And that's where the program was. At least now Mike Nabers built it to where people care about the program and they're upset. So that's, a good thing, but then it's a bad thing for Coach Nabers. And so I think he's getting the benefit of building a program and building the interest, and that's why he's getting one more year.
All right, I got a question. How can you say he's building a program? He's lost more players than the law should allow. He can get them here, but he can't keep them.
Well, I would say he's getting the quality of players that's never been here before, and they're not staying, or some of them aren't staying.
That's college sports in a nutshell.
Yeah.
What are you doing with that talent that we've never gotten here before? Absolutely nothing. Zero.
I mean, I agree with you. I mean, he hasn't done anything, but no one ever cared before. And now, because
you know
he's
what?
Built a little care,
you know what?
Yeah, people are getting upset.
You know what?
Which I think is
the
a good
best
thing.
The best job he should have ever had was Cabot High School.
He did pretty good up there on the Great Northwest Coast. I mean, he made it to a Final Four up there, right?
But he had Chelsea Plum. You and I and a service dog to the coach Washington. Come on, let's do some coaching, Mike Nabers. I just see him sitting there on the bench, letting Todd Schaefer coach, letting his other assistant coach get technical fouls. I want to see the head coach getting technical fouls. I don't want to hear about his collecting figurines and playing music on Dixon Street and his guitars. I want to see him winning.
I would say this is 6 years ago, you'd have never taught college basketball, women's college basketball in the University of Arkansas. And it never
happened. You're exactly right.
Happened.
But
at least it's happening now.
I'm perturbed now because he's stealing money.
All right, what else you got? We've talked enough about it.
We have. I think the only thing our baseball team needs to work on is building the bun a little bit better this week.
Yeah. No, there was some miscommunication with the pitcher and first baseman on several occasions. And you know Dave Van Horn. He's the one who's in charge of that. I'm sure that's something they'll be working on this week to get that down because he stresses fielding. And that's very important to him. So, yeah, sometimes when you're playing a good team, those flaws get exposed. And now's the time to fix those flaws.
So, Wes, can you tell me, how do they decide which games go on Thursday, how they go on the Thursday, Friday, Saturday?
Yeah, the network executives get together and they choose which games. And they say, like, for example, this week with Arkansas-LSU, they're like, hey, we want to show this game on a Thursday. So then they move it to Thursday, Friday, Saturday. And normally, if they're going to have the crew there, they'll have them do two games. Like this week, one game's on what? ESPN2 on Thursday, and then it's the SEC Network on Friday. So if they're going to have the crew there, you might as well have them there for two games. So I was surprised that I guess the Auburn game, there was only one game that was quote, nationally televised. The other were streamed. So that's how it happens. And they just choose the best matchups and decide which ones are going to be on TV.
I can't wait for Thursday and Friday nights. It's going to be electric up in Fayetteville.
No doubt. No doubt about it. Brent, thanks, man. Glad you got it off your chest.
Thank you.
Yep. 661-1037. We'll take some more phone calls later in the day, but we got Kendall Dix coming up. I'm excited to talk a little baseball with him. Man, he got off to a slow start at the plate, but he finished strong on Saturday. I think he had a double and a triple maybe in his last two at-bats. Had made some good plays out in the field. Had a good catch or two. Diving catch that saved a run. Ended the inning. Let's see what Kendall thought of the weekend. Winning a series is great, especially on the road against a ranked team. Man, you're like, I was getting greedy. I was getting greedy thinking it's time to sweep. Got a nice lead. Turned it over to the bullpen. They've been so reliable. Gackle just didn't have it. Couldn't locate his slider. Just kept missing. Barely missing.
It's hard to beat a team three times in a three-game series.
It is. A good team. And Auburn is good. I mean, watching them play, they're got a nice team. We'll take a break. Kendall Dix coming up next. It's Out of Bounds.
Fence Brokers presents Razorback Graffiti every Monday morning. Call Morning Mayhem and let them know how you feel about how they did. One sentence and one sentence only.
This is SportsCenter.
The Sweet 16 in the NCAA tournament is set. It starts back up on Thursday, where we'll have Clemson versus Arizona at 6:09, a rematch on last year's national championship game, UConn versus San Diego State at 6:39, Alabama taking on North Carolina at 8:39, and then in the late game, we'll have Iowa State facing Illinois at 9:09. On Friday, NC State, who's the lowest seed left in the tournament at an 11 seed, will take on Marquette at 6:09. Purdue and Gonzaga will go at it at 6:39. Houston and Duke will face each other at 8:39, and then Creighton and Tennessee will end the night when they tip off at 9:09. And the coaching carousel in college basketball continues. Florida Atlantic's head coach Dusty May is now the head coach at Michigan, while Drake's head coach Darian DeVries made the move to West Virginia. I'm Christian Weaver with the Buzz Radio Network.
Hey there, Arkansas. It's Rowdy Hogg Pickleball calling. Are you ready to join in the fun? Discover why pickleball is the fastest growing sport in America. It's an absolute blast for the whole family. Rowdy Hogg Pickleball has equipment for all budgets. And here's the best part. Indoor courts are coming soon. And membership is free. Don't miss out on the action. Conveniently located in the outlets of Little Rock. And visit RowdyHoggPickleball.com for your free membership.
Hi, I'm Trey Reed from the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission, inviting you to join me every Wednesday morning for the latest news from the great outdoors. It's brought to you by Arts Marine in North Little Rock, now under new ownership, but with the same familiar faces and incredible service you've known for years, plus the area's best selection of boating parts and supplies.
Hi, I'm Rick Pennington of Lion's Drug. We have great news. Generic Cialis is now available at a huge savings. We have Tadalafil, the FDA-approved generic of Cialis, in a 20-milligram tablet at a savings of up to 80%. We have the 5-milligram daily tablets for less than $3 a pill. Lion's Drug continues to be your go-to pharmacy for men's health. What are you waiting for? Call us today at 844-676-2247. Or go to our website at lionsdrug.com.
Well, we are starting to make that move into warmer weather, and it's about time for you to get out and move again. Hey, everybody, it's RJ Hawk here for QC Kinetics. Do you have joint pain? Is your back hurting? Are your knees hurting? What about those shoulders? I know baseball and softball season are starting to kick up, and you want to be able to throw the ball with your kid, but that pain is bothering you right now. You need to get over and see my friends over at QC Kinetics for a free consultation. They are the nation's leader in regenerative medicine, and what I'm talking about is you can get lasting joint pain relief with no surgery, no drugs, and no downtime. Pro athletes have been doing this for decades, but now this life-changing treatment is available for you. No pain pills, no risky surgery. This is an all-natural solution. Oh, and by the way, it's a great use of your tax refund check. Call QC Kinetics for a free consultation. 501-222-8440. 501-222-8440. That's 501-222-8440.
Hey, I'm Joseph Pena with the Arkansas basketball team. Great news. Bell & Sword & Conway has everything for dad. Belts, cufflinks, wallets, colognes, cool and colorful happy socks, belts, U of A and UCA polos, swim trunks, sport coats, shirts, summer slacks, and shorts. Remember, Bell & Sword is the only men's store in Central Arkansas with Taylor on staff. Bell & Sword, 1011 Oak Street on Facebook and Instagram.
Is your Oak Lawn Thoroughbred racing action so close you can feel it? Or is it the view from your trackside luxury suite? However you like it, racing season is off and running at Oak Lawn with live races every weekend through May 4th. It's fun by the furlong all season long. Make your reservations today at oaklawn.com. What's your Oak Lawn? Gambling problem? Call 1-800-522-4700.
Make your tailgate the party of the parking lot by getting the best meats in all of Arkansas at Hogg's Meat Market, the steak people. Out of Bounds with Joe Franklin and Wes Moore on 103.7 The Buzz.
Back to Out of Bounds, Wes Moore, Joe Franklin, working to get Kendall Diggs on here. We'll get him on here in a bit. We'll talk some NCAA basketball, though. Mentioned what Gonzaga has done. 9 straight Sweet 16s. 9 years in a row to go to the Sweet 16. Talk about consistency. We were getting spoiled around here. We thought 3 in a row was great, right? Now everybody's mad because they didn't get to the tournament. 9 times in a row. That's incredible, Joe.
It is, but at the same time, think about their fan base because they expect to get far every year in the tournament. And if it ends in a Sweet 16, they're really upset because they feel like it's championship or bust every year, and they still haven't quite gotten over the hump.
Yeah, so many years, you know, they're not all 9, but a lot of those years, you know, they have such a high seed. And so they're in a great position to go to the Sweet 16, not fighting like as an 8 seed to be the number 1 to get to the Sweet 16. But they set themselves up during the regular season. And that would be the one thing I would love to see Arkansas do and Coach Mossman and his teams do a better job of getting a top 4 seed. So you're favored. You should get to the Sweet 16. I mean, tell Kentucky that.
Pressure's always on, especially when you have those high seeds.
Tell Auburn that. It doesn't mean you're going to get to the Sweet 16, but it gives you a better chance. But Mark Few on making 9 straight Sweet 16s.
Oh, great. I mean, hey, it does get harder. I mean, it's always hard, and I think that's what people need to understand. Sometimes you got to just take a step back and whether it's making – I think we've been to 26 straight. I mean, the thing that people don't realize, we qualified for the COVID year. We won our tournament, and we're sitting around waiting to see where we were sent. So we were in that tournament. We didn't need any help with at-larges or anything. But, yeah, the Sweet 16 thing, we don't take it for granted at all. It's. I'll say it again, I think it's the greatest sporting event in the entire world. It's just so exciting and so just – awesome to be a part of it, and probably even better than that is being able to take your groups through it. And to your point, like, hey, about mid-December or actually late December, this probably was it was looking like, hey, maybe it wasn't going to happen, you know. But these guys, I'll give them credit. They remain coachable this entire year. They just stuck with it, stuck with it. They believed in the program and the staff and what we're trying to do. And lo and behold, we finally figured it out.
Yeah, once again, Mark Few and Gonzaga back in the Sweet 16. They'll take on Purdue on the 29th. So that's correct, right? The 29th. This print, gosh, I printed out a fresh bracket without a bunch of X's and O's on it so I could read it clearly and see all the matchups. But yeah, we have the 28th and the 29th. So the left-hand side of your bracket plays Thursday. The right-hand side of your bracket plays on Friday. So Purdue and Gonzaga, man, what a great game that'll be. One versus a five. Gonzaga.
And then the shooting in that game? Gonzaga, you know, they had a powerful matchup against Kansas, and you get that in the second round when you're talking about fours and fives taking on each other for a chance to play against the one seed. And when you're talking about fours and fives, you're almost talking about that like the 8-9 matchup. These are teams that are supposed to be close on paper, and you get some of those better matchups. So – not really ever a surprise when a five is playing against a one as opposed to a four playing against a one.
I'm pulling up my Bet Saracen app because that is, to me, is going to be a high-scoring game. Purdue and Gonzaga. Over-under is 154.5. Let me put a little something on the over. Gonzaga scored 80-plus points in both of their matchups, and Purdue scored 100 against Utah State and 78 against Grambling State. You know, and they called off the dogs in that game
early.
So yeah, to me, that's an easy over on that one. I like that one a lot. Fun matchup there. Also excited to see Tennessee Creighton in the bottom half of that Midwest. They're playing these games in Detroit. Tennessee fans, they'll make that trip up to Detroit for this big weekend for Rick Barnes.
Coach, you said there are a lot of special people on the other side of the bench. Now that the dust has settled, how special was this weekend for you, considering where this regional was and how it shook out for you guys?
Well, you know, my first year in college coaching as a volunteer at Davidson, my very first game as a volunteer assistant, we played at the old Charlotte Coliseum, and we won our first game there against Brown, and I still have that watch that said that, and we were the Charlotte Invitational champions, and that was our goal coming here. And I said, we're in the Charlotte Invitational Tournament right now. There's four teams. And again, I can't tell you how much respect I have for, I could talk all night about Texas and their staff. I'm looking at one of my favorite players sitting right there that was the first high school player that we signed at the University of Texas, Chris Ogden, and he's truly like a son to me. And you know, the game played exactly how I knew they were going to play so hard. They knew we were going to play hard. They did an incredible job on Dalton, and we knew shots were going to be hard to come by. We did feel it. If we could maybe get inside a little bit, thought we could get them in some ball screen. And we had some looks, and we knew they were going to go to a matchup at some point. We knew that was coming because the last time we played them, we saw it, and we got the shots that we thought we could get out of it and some back cuts. But I'm just, again, it's that, just so you know, that tournament was probably about, 45 years ago, you know, whatever it was, as long as I've been in it. But just proud of our team, but really proud of the effort of both teams. I thought both teams played their hearts out. And to win a game like this when you shoot as poorly as we did, and they had something to do with that. There were some shots that we forced, but their defense was there. But to win a game like this in this tournament, you know, again, I'm just proud of the effort our guys put in there on the defensive end.
I think that's exactly what Tennessee needed. They needed one of those games where they didn't play well offensively or didn't shoot the ball well offensively to get by. And they did. They escaped Texas. That was a defensive battle. But early on in that game, Tennessee was missing wide open shots. And Joe Klein, who will be here in the third hour, he and I and you, we've talked about Tennessee. It seems like every now and then they have one of those games where the offense, just nothing's happening for them. And it's hard to believe with all the players, offensive players that they have, that they could struggle offensively. But we've seen that from time to time. And in years past, they weren't good enough to overcome that in the tournament. This year they got by that game. And they looked so good in the first round game. Offense was clicking, moving the ball. And I'm like, that. Here comes Tennessee. This is the team. This is a team that I picked to win it all. They're looking good. Texas couldn't make a shot. I mean, they were missing layups, Joe. They were underneath, just a little gimme, missing it. Nothing would fall. It was like, you know, the old lid is on the basket for them. Rimming out, halfway down, coming out, popping out. And you're just like, gosh, they can't buy a basket. But because of the defense, and they were able to get by and make a couple of shots when needed and escape this game against Texas. Just watch out. I feel good after they escape that game.
Most of the time in any sport, you on a journey to win a championship, you'll have teams that are going to have games like that along the way. The only time it stands out that it didn't seem like that was UConn last year. UConn had no struggles, but their teams – You can pick a team, championship team, and think about, you know, the games that they played along to win a championship. And you can pick out a game where they struggled a bit. It happens all the time. And even with Houston, think about the game that Houston had last night against A&M, where they looked comfortable. They had control of the game, but then they lost control. They're able to go on and win that game, because when it goes to overtime, it looks like A&M has everything it takes to go ahead and win it. They had to come back, and it looked like they were on their way to win the game, but Houston prevailed. That could be a game for Houston that you look at to say, okay, Houston had a bump there, and it looked like they weren't going to be able to overcome it, but they did, and then they go on to do great things from there.
I think Tennessee covers against Creighton, the 2.5. I like that on the Bet Saracen app, but I really love the over in that game, 143.5.
That's going to be about the overs this weekend.
Creighton can score. And when Tennessee's playing, they can score. I think this is going to be a game that gets in the 80s. The winner gets in the 80s. I think this one goes over 150.
Another team that looks good that maybe is being slept on is Arizona. They've looked really good. And talking about UNC and having that experience that they have, Caleb Love, who was on that UNC team, is now on Arizona. Arizona looks really good.
And I like their matchup against Clemson. Although, you know, Clemson early in the season, I remember they had a nice win. It was one of those eye-popping wins. I can't remember who it was, but it's like, okay. And Joe was in here. And Joe may have done a game with Clemson or had watched Clemson. He was talking that Clemson had a good team. He told this early in the season. I don't think it's a cakewalk for Arizona, but I like the matchup, and it wouldn't surprise me if Arizona wins that game and moves on to play either North Carolina or Alabama. North Carolina, speaking of Hubert Davis and North Carolina, they were in a dogfight against Michigan State, and they didn't look great in the first half at all.
Coach, I didn't have to tee you up at the end of the first quarter. I have a feeling I don't have to now.
No, I was pretty fired up. I just didn't feel like from the competitive fire to start the game. They were more physical than us. The will and their want to overpowered us. I said, we can't even talk about basketball until we join the fight. About the 10-minute mark in the first half, then they started competing and everything turned for us.
And then they put it on them and rolled in the second half against Michigan State. Now they'll take on Alabama. And I said earlier with Alabama, offensive team that scared me because they don't play a lot of defense. Defense seems to be optional with this team. They won. They beat Grand Canyon because they played defense the other night. And that was almost shocking to see. They got down and got after Grand Canyon. And maybe it was just a competitor. You realize your shot's not falling that night. And they did something that I haven't seen them do very often this year, and that was D up a team like Grand Canyon. And that's a good team. Grand Canyon's a good team.
Yeah, you do what you have to do once you get into the game and make those necessary adjustments. There are certain things you're going to have to do in-game to win and pull these games out.
Yeah, North Carolina's to me, is not a team where they can go and just outscore. I don't think they have – they've been able to do that against some SEC teams. I just don't know if they can do that against North Carolina. I don't know if they can just go and put 100 on North Carolina and still win. That North Carolina could put 102 on them if they don't play defense. So maybe that's a good precursor for them, and it's something to build on. You're going to have to play defense like you did against Grand Canyon, against North Carolina, and you're going to have to shoot the ball well to pull off the upset.
That's Bama's game, and that has been probably for about three seasons now where they're going to shoot a ton of threes. They're going to get shots at the rim, easy shots at the rim, dunks, layups. That's what they want to do. You can look at their shot chart from pretty much any game they play, but those shots from the outside, they're not always going to fall. So they do have to make adjustments on certain things when those shots aren't falling. But their game has been their game for about three seasons, mm-hmm. and that's just what they do. That's the way they play.
But they have been better defensively in previous years. They
had rim protectors,
yeah.
And not that they don't now, but they had maybe more guys that were more aware of mm-hmm. rim protection.
Mm-hmm. All right, we'll talk more about the NCAA tournament when we come back. We'll also take some phone calls, 661-1037, 661-1037. We can go through the East and the South, the teams that are left, hear from some of the head coaches. Let's look at the Midwest, look at the West. We'll take a look at the Southern Structural Solutions text line also. Stick around. It's Out of Bounds.
Hello, folks. It's Frank Fletcher from the Fletcher Dodge Store here in Sherwood. For the past few months, we've been asking you to give us a chance to buy your cars, and the response has been great. We really appreciate all of you who brought your cars in and turned it into cash. We've purchased hundreds of cars from fine people just like you. Folks, we're still buying cars every day. So look around and see what you or your family has in the garage that you want to turn into cash. It's really easy, folks. Just come into Fletcher Dodge and ask for Chris or Andy. We'll buy any vehicle and we'll pay you more than anyone. We can't find enough vehicles at the auto auctions to meet the demand, so we're extending you this offer to the public. We'll pay you more, so don't wait. We've purchased hundreds of cars from fine people just like you. Come see us today for the best cash offer on your car, truck, van, or SUV. Just ask for Chris or Andy. We'll pay you more, so come see us at Fletcher Dodge on Warden Road in Sherwood. Thanks.
Through the end of March, the deals could not be hotter at Arch Marine in North Little Rock. Ready for this? The ever-so-popular G3 boats with rebates up to $3,000 off already discounted 2022 and 23 models. The deals are hot, hot, hot at Arch Marine in North Little Rock. Come see us.
Tito's Handmade Vodka presents the 2024 1037 The Buzz Spring Golf Tournament, Monday, April 15th at the Burns Park Golf Course. Register your four-person team at 1037thebuzz.com. Brought to you in part by Lion Legal.
Do you need Rainwater Holt and Sexton? Anywhere in the state, dial 888-8888. It really is just that easy. If you've been injured and need help, it doesn't matter where in Arkansas you are. Just dial 888-8888. We'll come to you. I'm Mike Rainwater of Rainwater Holt & Sexton. We have been thankfully serving Arkansans for years, and we appreciate the trust you've put in us. We work hard for you, Arkansas, each and every day. Anywhere in the state, dial 8.
There are any number of reasons you might consider selling your home. To move closer to family, live within a smaller budget, or just wanting a change of scenery. Whatever your reasons, having to figure out all the various housing market trends in your area may not be what you signed up for. That's where an agent who is a Realtor comes in. Realtors have the expertise to help you find the right price and navigate the process to sell your home in a way that's right for you. That's who we are. Realtors are members of the National Association of Realtors.
Getting your biggest tax refund from Jackson Hewitt can lead to some spirited reactions.
Jackson Hewitt, yeah!
Jackson Hewitt is so sure they'll get you your biggest refund that if they don't, you get your money back plus $100.
Jackson Hewitt, yeah!
Switch to Jackson Hewitt and we'll beat what you paid last year, even if you filed online.
Hewitt, yeah!
Ain't nothing to it. Switch to Jackson Hewitt and pay less for tax prep, guaranteed. Proof of prior year payment required when filing. New clients only at participating locations through April 7th. Terms at jacksonhewitt.com.
Willie D's Rock and Roll Piano Bar open every Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. Cold drinks and dueling pianos. Deep Nightclub downstairs hosts karaoke on Tuesdays and DJ spin on Friday and Saturday nights. Visit WillieD'sPianoBar.com. Come and get your Willie on.
Got a wedding in your future? Say yes to the Arkansas Democrat Gazette wedding show Sunday, April 21st at the Stables at Cherokee Creek in Conway. Tickets are now available. With more than 30 exhibitors, fashion, and giveaways, the Conway wedding show is not to be missed. Sponsored in part by Dillard's and Central Arkansas Entertainment, tickets are $10 in advance to the April 21st Conway wedding show. Visit ArkansasBridalCommunity.com for more info or call 501-378-3807.
Bubba Carpenter joins Justin Acree and DJ Williams in the Zone every week this baseball season, presented by Johnston's Home Center in Benton. Johnson's Home Center. If they don't have it, you probably don't need it.
Have a watch party that everyone wants to attend at your house with the best of meats in the business. Hogg's Meat Market, the Steak People. Out of Bounds with Wes Moore and Joe Franklin on 103.7 The Buzz.
Tell me, do you see her? She's living her life. Even if she acts like she don't want the limelight. But if you knew her, she lives a lie. She calls a paparazzi, then she acts surprised.
Welcome back to Out of Bounds. Wes Moore and Joe Franklin. Glad you're with us. Arkansas State's having a really good first half. Red Wolves are playing Montana in the CBI tournament down in Daytona Beach, Florida. Last check, they're up 40-23. They've hit eight threes in the first half. Hit eight threes and a half. That'll get you going.
Oh, yeah. Give you a good chance to win.
So Darian Ford has three threes in the first half. So good luck to the Red Wolves as they try to advance down in Daytona Beach, Florida.
That's an interesting tournament also because it goes Saturday through Wednesday nonstop. It's day after day. Mm-hmm. So you know that, you know, if you start on Saturday, you're going to have four or five games to get it done.
They were off Sunday. So you had your first round games on Saturday, Sunday, and then they turn around play today, tomorrow, Wednesday.
Yes. So four games to win it all. And the one seed has to win three games. So it's a 15-team tournament. And the one seed gets a bye.
Weekend recap brought to you by Fleet Management Services, serving Central Arkansas for over 20 years. They're your small to mid-sized specialist. When you need someone to service your fleet and get your employees back on the road quick, call 501-375-3672.
We were taking a look at the NCAA tournament and some of the matchups for this coming weekend. Joe, you found a really cool story on CBSSports.com, and it was re-ranking the 16 teams that are left. And I had an issue with a couple of them, with some of them.
It also gives their original seeding, too. So that makes it a little more interesting also because, you know, when you're going through your bracket and getting the teams that you see to advance on, like we said, with this tournament this year, there are a lot of high seeds that are in there. Mm-hmm. And then with NC State, they're going to be the lowest ranked on, you know, most the way that most people would have it. It's just interesting to see where they ranked before and then how they would rank now. Because if they would rank out, you know, lower than 16, that means that they weren't necessarily expected to be in the Sweet 16. But it's all based on matchups.
Top four pretty much the same. Houston slid from number two to number four. I guess just because they played a tough game against Texas A&M. But UConn, number one, they look like the overall number one seed. Purdue up to number two from original number three. North Carolina up one spot from four to three. Number five is Arizona. They were previously seeded number six, so not much of a move there for Arizona. Iowa State, ranked number six. Up from number eight. I'll be honest, I don't know if I watched any of Iowa State's first two games. Missed them both.
Watched a bit of both their games, but they were able to do what it takes to and they've been playing good basketball all season.
Duke is ranked number eight. I skipped Illinois. They're seven. Duke is number eight, originally ranked number 13. Gonzaga, a big mover. Originally ranked number 21, they're all the way up to number 9. Both of their wins came by 21 points. And Mark Few and the Bulldogs just rolled right through the first two rounds. Marquette fell from 7 to 10. Watched a little bit of Marquette, you know, Friday when we had Steve Sullivan on. He was worried because Marquette was trailing at the half. And I pointed out, look, hey, don't worry. Western Kentucky shot lights out in the first half. They're not going to keep that up. And sure enough, they came back to earth and Marquette just ran by Western Kentucky in the first round. Same thing happened Sunday. I noticed when I got out of church Sunday, Marquette was shooting the lights out in the first half. And they were only up by like 10, 11, 12 points at the half. And I thought they were in a little bit of trouble against Colorado because I was like, I didn't think Marquette would continue to shoot like that. And sure enough, Colorado came back and gave them a heck of a game there Sunday afternoon. That was a little stressful on Marquette.
No lead is safe. Double-digit leads, they're there for the time being, but basketball is a game of runs, and teams are going to make runs.
Creighton started out ranked number 10 and just fell one spot to 11. Tennessee was one of the big droppers, and I'd kind of take exception with that. Tennessee came in ranked number 5. They were the highest number 2 seed, and CBSSports.com says they're number 12 out of all the teams left because they went 3 of 25 from the three-point line, in part against Texas. And to me, you go 3 of 25 and you still find a way to beat a team like Texas? That's not a negative. That's a positive to me, Joe. You shot that poorly, and we know Tennessee's not a 3 for 25 team. They had a bad day. Most teams go 3 of 25, you're going to lose.
Yeah.
Especially against a quality team like Texas.
Well, you would have to think that the way that this is reseeded is based on not just one game, but the way that they played through the two games.
Well, first game, they were awesome.
Yeah, but
they may have looked better than anybody in the first game, maybe besides UConn.
It's not necessarily the, you know, Tennessee against Tennessee. It's Tennessee where they stack up against the
everybody
rest of the
else. Clemson is ranked number 13. Originally, they were ranked number 22, so for a big jump for them. San Diego State ranked number 14. Alabama, about the same. They were ranked number 15 to start the tournament, or 16 to start the tournament. Now they're ranked 15. And North Carolina State, of course, the 11 seed. They're ranked as the worst team left at number 16.
But look at their original seeding, 45.
Wow. I would not pick against North Carolina State. I'm sorry. Because they are so hot right now. They have all the confidence in the world. They've won 7 straight games, 8 straight games. They're feeling it. They're feeling good right now. Their confidence is through the roof. They got Marquette. We'll have to look at that line during the break.
We may need to look at the other team from NC State, the women's team. May need to look in the broadcast in their games.
What's that?
Coached by Wes
Moore. Coach Wes Moore, yeah. Wow! North Carolina State's a 6.5-point underdog. Give me some of that. Go with the dog in that game. All right, we're up against it, Shane. Sorry.
Buzzbecue Saturday, May 11th at the downtown Riverside RV Park in North Little Rock. Tickets on sale soon.
Is your Oaklawn Thoroughbred racing action so close you can feel it? Or is it the view from your trackside luxury suite? However you like it, racing season is off and running at Oaklawn with live races every weekend through May 4th. It's fun by the furlong all season long. Make your reservations today at oaklawn.com. What's your Oaklawn? Gambling problem? Call 1-800-522-4700.
Calling all coaches. Summerwood Sports in Bryant. It's your go-to destination for basketball and volleyball tournaments, practices, and more. Conveniently located off Interstate 30, it's the premier sports complex in Central Arkansas with up to 4 courts and 2 gyms. Summerwood Sports is perfect for training sessions, team practices, and even epic birthday parties. Check availability and learn more at summerwoodsports.com. Elevate your game at Summerwood Sports.
When you want to know the score, it's on KABZ Little Rock.
He's open, completed the 10, the 5, touchdown Arkansas!
103.7 The Buzz.
Buzz News with Channel 7's Cassandra Webb.
In Hot Springs, police are continuing their investigation after one person was killed and 2 others were injured in a shooting. Police were called to the 200 block of Beard Street Friday afternoon. They found a pair of 20-year-olds shot inside a car. The driver, identified as Adriana Howell, was pronounced dead on the scene. The other victim was injured and taken to the hospital. Police then found a third victim on North Patterson Street shot in the leg. That victim was taken to the hospital for treatment. If you know anything about what happened, call the Hot Springs police. The Democratic race for Justice of the Peace District 9 between incumbent Judy Green and Tina Renee Ward is yet to be settled. Polls will open from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. tomorrow at the Pulaski County Regional Building, D. Brown Library, and Glenview Community Center. Anyone who lives in District 9 and voted in the Democratic primary or cast a nonpartisan ballot can vote. Absentee ballots must be turned in no later than 7:30 on the night of the election. From the Channel 7 Newsroom, I'm Cassandra Webb.
Pickup Truck Accessory Warehouse presents Match Game on Morning Mayhem. Listen for your chance to play their version of the classic TV game show. Brought to you by Pickup Truck Accessory Warehouse, Arkansas's truck accessory headquarters for over 30 years. Call 501-568-0040 today or click online at arkansastruck.com.
Weather from the Fletcher Weather Center with Channel 7's Melinda Mayo.
Showers and thunderstorms increasing during the day. Overall, the severe weather threat is low, but there could be some gusty severe winds, and even an isolated tornado or two cannot be ruled out, especially across southeastern Arkansas. From the Channel 7 Weather Center, I'm meteorologist Melinda Mayo.
Fletcher Dodge wants to buy your car. We'll buy any make or model, and we'll pay you more than anyone else. Please, turn your old car into cash at Fletcher Dodge in Sherwood.
Tune in every Friday morning to hear Danny West from HogSports.com on Morning Mayhem. Brought to you by HJ Trailer Sales. They've got truck beds and utility trailers for every type of job and a service facility for maintenance and repair. Local folks with great products. Visit them online at HJTrailerSales.com or in person at 808 Albert Pike in Hot Springs.
It's the Ranger Open House Sale through Monday at Bradford Marine and ATV at all six statewide locations. Last of the boat show deals, like the Ranger 520R with 250 horsepower Mercury with trailer and up to a $2,000 Bass Pro gift card and discounts up to $10,000 on select models. Or check out the SunTracker Sportfish 22, great for fishing and cruising with 115 horsepower Mercury outboard. Don't miss the Open House Sale today through April 1st at all Bradford Marine and ATV statewide locations. Your authorized Ranger and Tracker dealer.
If you are looking for a safe and loving home for you or your loved one, visit Heartland Rehabilitation and Care Center. Just 15 minutes from Little Rock in Benton, our skilled nursing staff is dedicated to providing quality long-term care and short-term therapy. Visit heartlandrehabcenter.com. You can call Heartland home.
Are you ready for a better forklift experience? River Valley Tractor and Castle Forklift have teamed up to manage your material handling needs. From diesel, lithium, propane, and so much more, Castle's product line is versatile, ready for the next generation of consumers to make every job easier. Step into the future of forklift innovation. Choose Castle. Visit River Valley Tractor, your authorized Castle forklift dealers in Central Arkansas.
The Powerball jackpot from the Arkansas Scholarship Lottery is now more than $600 million. So, what would you do if you won?
If I won the jackpot, I would buy my own racehorse.
If I won the lottery, I would buy my wife a beach house.
First person I would call would be my husband. He's got a big mouth, but I would still call him first.
Got your ticket? If not, visit your local lottery retailer for your chance to win the Powerball jackpot of more than $600 million. This is winning. Call 1-800-522-4700 for Problem Gambling Helpline.
And ESPN Radio Extra Point with Peter Burns.
Coach Cal, Mitch Barnhart look at each other and go, listen, are we better off with having somebody else coach? Probably not. Are there issues that need to be resolved? Yes. Are you overpaid for what you're delivering? There is zero doubt about it. And at some point, Harbaugh and Michigan said, all right, let's reduce the amount of money that you're earning and show me that you can do it. Well, guess what? Michigan did that. There was a renewed sense of vigor behind Harbaugh. And guess what? Look at what just happened. They won a national championship, and now he's over to the NFL. So if I'm Cal, I want to coach this team. He can recruit. There's never a doubt on recruiting, but he has to change. If you're Rich Barnhart, do you really go grab somebody else or pay $33 million? No. So now Mitch Barnhart's going to put himself in a situation going, hey, man, if we can't work this out, is there somebody that's going to adjust?
Now streaming only on Disney Plus.
My name is Taylor. Welcome to the Eras Tour.
Experience Taylor Swift's record-breaking Eras Tour. Swift The Eras Tour, Taylor's version, with four additional acoustic songs. Now streaming only on Disney Plus.
Save big during MVP's bonus days at Lowe's with limited time deals on everything you need. Right now, buy one select DeWalt 20-volt max tool. Get one DeWalt 20-volt max power stack battery 2-pack free, a $179 value. Plus, save $20 on a select bucket of Deck Plus wood screws. Find these deals and more in-store and online today. Because Lowe's knows savings. Lowe's knows pros. Valid 318 through 329 while supplies last. Selection varies by location.
Live from the Hogs Meat Market Studios, this is Out of Bounds with Joe Franklin and Wes Moore on 103.7 The Buzz. It's time for your Razor Hog update on Out of Bounds. Brought to you by Floyd's Seafood, Keele Avenue in Sherwood. It's crawfish season. Floyd's Seafood has live and cooked crawfish. Order yours today.
A lot of stuff to get to in the Razor Hog update. See, the Arkansas women's gymnastic team is seeded number 10 in the country in the regionals. They're going to host a regional at Bud Walton Arena. They're going to host number 2 LSU, number 7 Kentucky, number 15 Minnesota, Arizona, Nebraska, Oregon State, and Boise State. Oh, and BYU. Softball team lost 2-3 over the weekend to Mississippi State. That wasn't good. Jersey Wolfenbarger, Brent and Stuttgart, or now Brent and Cersei. Hope he's sitting down. Jersey Wolfenbarger has decided she's going to transfer, and she entered the portal. You know, she sat out all year. She's decided where she's going. LSU.
There you go.
Whoa. Well, one of the top athletes in the portal, and she's going to LSU. She made that announcement about 40 minutes ago. And then the Razorbacks baseball team. A lot of news surrounding them. You got perfect game, D1 baseball, the coaches poll, everybody voting Arkansas number one again. Hagen Smith is the co-SEC pitcher of the week. I almost made him the pitcher of the year. He's on his way.
Yeah, maybe, yeah.
He's on his way. Great Thursday night game. 6 innings, gave up 3 hits, 12 strikeouts, no earned runs. Hagen Smith was the ace on Thursday night. Man, he shut Auburn down. And as the series went along, you saw Auburn can hit the ball. Didn't look like they could hit it at all on Thursday night. But that was in part to Hagen Smith and what he was able to do. And today he was the co-SEC pitcher of the week. And the Arkansas Little Rock game is going to be played a little earlier tomorrow. It was supposed to be a 6:30 tip first pitch. They're going to go at 3:00 tomorrow. Hey, does that mean we get out of here at 2:30?
No, that's not what it means.
We're not going to have it on the main Buzz tomorrow afternoon. We're going to have it on Buzz 2.
Yeah.
Are we sure?
usually it affects drive time more so than us.
Yeah, okay. And then same with softball. They've moved up the Arkansas softball game with UCA to 5:00 tomorrow. They're trying to beat the cold temperatures before it gets unbearable in Fayetteville tomorrow. Let me see what that app looks like. It's supposed to, once this line of thunderstorms moves through here, that rain should be coming here pretty soon through Little Rock. It's going to get down in the 50s around here. And in Fayetteville tomorrow, let's see here, the high is 51. Cloudy and 51 tomorrow. So that's why they want to play in the afternoon before it gets down in the 30s tomorrow night. They got some low, they're going to have freezing temperatures Wednesday in Fayetteville. Wednesday morning, 30 degrees. So it's a powerful little cool front. All right, we're going to get Coach Curry on here, talk a little Little Rock baseball. They're getting ready to take on the Razorbacks tomorrow afternoon. And they took 2-3 over the weekend. It was a good weekend for the Little Rock Trojans. And it was two of the best teams in the OVC playing each other. Coach Curry joins us now. Coach, welcome to Out of Bounds. Got to feel good after week one of conference play?
It does. It does. You know, it faced Moorhead State, who went to a regional out of our league last year, and it actually came down to us and them last year on the final weekend for the league championship, and they got us. So it was good to get the series win to open up this weekend. And we're disappointed. We wanted to get all three, and we're pretty dominant in the first two games, but let some walks get away from us and created some innings for them, and that's not a good recipe for winning. But 24 hours later, we look back at it, and glad we won the series.
Coach, what have you liked so far this season from baseball team, and what are some of the challenges you guys have faced?
Yeah, so, you know, going into the season, all the talk was about Jackson Wells, and rightfully so, preseason pitcher of the year and led the nation in ERA last year. And it's hard to duplicate that 2 years in a row. And Jackson has been good, but still working on figuring out some things as far as his delivery and getting his body exactly where he wants it, mainly his arm. But in the meantime, Hoss Brewer, who was our number two last year, has kind of traded places with Jackson and just announced about an hour ago he was Ohio Valley Pitcher of the Week. On Friday, he struck out 11 through seven innings, only allowed one hit. And so we kind of put Hoss in that Friday night role and then Jackson on Saturday, which what a great Saturday pitcher. I mean, yeah. If you win on Friday, you feel good about your chances to win the series on Saturday. And then our bullpen's been really, really good with Jacob Weatherly, Austin Stover, and Aaron McKnight, and also some additions with Beasley, who's an Australian sidearmer, and Hunter Royal. And so our pitching has been better than we thought. We started off a little slow offensively. Part of that we attribute to a tough schedule, and seeing some good arms, which got us ready for OVC pitching. But this weekend, we had a good offensive weekend.
Coach, we had this question on the Southern Structural Solutions feedback or text line. Baseball and so much of college baseball and even the major leagues, it's all about winning the series. You know, you want to win the series. It's just talked about over and over and over. Just go win the series. When you take those win the first two games, is there a natural tendency, and you know, we even saw it with the Razorbacks this weekend, do you let down on that third game after you've already won the series? Or as a coach, do you try to hammer home, hey, let's be greedy and sweep this thing?
Oh, you nailed it. You know, I think it's human nature. You know, human nature is to relax. Human nature is to let our guard down and forget the intensity and the effort and the focus that it took to get those two wins. And so, of course, the coaches, I mean, we're preaching, we're jumping up and down, we're blue in the face, hey, same intensity tomorrow, let's get this done. You know, and what is the coaching staff, you understand after doing it for a while, is you never know when that Sunday win that you pick up in March or April could turn around and be the win that pushes you over the edge for a league championship. And it's good to have the head-to-head against someone if you come down to a tie. But as much as you can, it's a great question, Wes, you try to emphasize the importance of winning that third game and sweeping somebody. That's why we call it Championship Sunday, because typically in a tournament, in a regional, or for the league, it's decided on Sunday. The series many times decided on Sunday or sweep. But it's human nature, especially with, you know, 18 to 22, 23, 24-year-olds, say, okay, we've got this, even though the coaching staff is reiterating how important and vital this third game is.
Coach, coming up tomorrow, Little Rock Trojans take on Arkansas Razorbacks. How has this game and these games been for you since Little Rock and Arkansas have been playing these in-state games?
Well, we always enjoy and embrace the opportunity. They're always ranked really high. We're used to that, and that's a compliment to their program. It's always a good opportunity for us to see quality pitching, which I feel like helps us going into the weekend. We're at Lindenwood on the road next weekend for the short week being Easter. I think we both played Thursday, Friday, Saturday series. I'm not sure who they have, but we'll travel again on Wednesday to Lindenwood to get ready for Thursday. And I just feel like playing good competition on a Tuesday can kind of tighten some things up for you, and a great atmosphere. The weather is you know, going to be a little bit of a battle for both teams. I'm glad they decided to move it up. I think that was wise for the players. But we embrace this game. It's a challenge. We got a lot of Arkansas kids on our team, so they enjoy it. Our players know a lot of their players, have played against them coming up. So it's a fun atmosphere. We enjoy it.
And it's not often you get to play the number one team in the country. I'm sure that's, that'll have the guys ready to go, if not just playing Arkansas. That's a little added icing on the cake for you. How does that work with the game getting changed? Do they consult you at all, talk to you, ask if you're up for it, the decision-making? How did that work?
Sure. Their operations staff was in the communication, you know, this weekend that that could be a possibility. And so just checking to make sure for our travel that we could do that, and then communicating for sure this morning that we can confirm and do that with hotels and buses and all of those things. Of course, we were in total agreement watching the weather ourselves. And so I guess for baseball, different than basketball and football, it's just such a common thing, just playing the weather. You're kind of used to it, and you can kind of know that that's a possibility. And so pretty easy adjustment for us.
Also, about the adjustment with the quick turnarounds, you played yesterday, you play tomorrow, then that's going to be a quick turnaround playing on Thursday. So what's the schedule like for you guys at this time in adjusting to those quick turnarounds?
Yeah, we're kind of in the middle of it, and to be honest with you, this kind of eight-game stretch here is one that we circled in the offseason as being really, really tough. Going back to Murray State, who's you know, a top 30, top 40 RPI program, we had them 2 weekends ago. Then we had Oral Roberts last Tuesday, you know, go to Omaha last year. Then we had Morehead State at home, who won the league last year and went to a regional, and then you go to Fayetteville on Tuesday. And so it's been a flurry of tough baseball for us, and we've held our own and competed pretty well, except for yesterday, which got away from us a little bit because of some walks and things. But it'll be a quick turnaround. We'll get up in the morning and drive up and play our game in the afternoon, and then we'll drive home, and then we'll turn around middle of the morning on Wednesday and drive to St. Louis and play Thursday, Friday, Saturday. But we get that day back on the back end with being able to be home on Easter and, you know, go to church. And the pitchers will be on short rest this week, but they'll have an extra day next week.
Coach, I've seen it before in these midweek games when a team plays Arkansas and they get up for the game, and sometimes they'll do something a little different because it means so much to – you know, for their RPI or their whatever, you know, to knock off a top team like that. Sometimes they'll throw some of their better pitchers, even a weekend starter, for an inning instead of having a bullpen. They'll throw that guy out there for an inning. Will you do anything like that, or do you leave your weekend guys alone?
Our weekend guys, we're gonna leave them alone, and especially because of the short week. And to be honest, we've really, just like they do, we have really got our sights set on winning our league. And although this game is super important, it's a great RPI game, we do not and cannot afford to jeopardize our weekend pitching. Now, if we get in an opportunity, like last year, you know, Jacob Wedderly came in the fifth inning of the second game and was pitching really well, and we left him in longer than probably we wanted to, but we had an opportunity to win that game, and it was important, and so we left him out there. So our plan, and I would assume their plan, I don't know for sure, would be to use a lot of the bullpen and keep everybody's outings short so that we don't put ourselves in a bad position for the weekend. But I won't speak for them, but I know for us, I seriously, it's a good question. A lot of people do it. You're right, Wes. But I don't believe we'll do that, bring a starter from the weekend back. And mainly because of how many pitches our guys threw. None of them went an extravagant amount, but they threw enough to where we really don't need to get them cranked up and hot for a game situation. I think that would be detrimental for a short week.
Is there a requirement as far as the coaches letting the other coach know who's going to be the starting pitcher before the game or at a certain time? Is that protocol or is that just common courtesy? How does that work?
It's courtesy. I've never seen anything in writing, but it's probably as close to the number one top unwritten rule in baseball. And there's about 100 unwritten rules in baseball, but that would probably be up there, you know, near the top, is just letting the other team know your rotation or who's pitching tomorrow 24 hours in advance. And I've not run into any situations yet where a team tries to play games with that or trick you, it would be highly disrespectful for someone to do that. And I'll be honest, in my whole coaching career, I've only heard of it once or twice. And you know, if you don't know, you can say TBA to be announced. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I've played games where we truly don't know, you know, who's throwing tomorrow. It's because that usually means that the possible starters are available for today. But yeah, that's a good question. We try to make it a point to reciprocate and you know, be transparent about that, because we want to know as well who the other team is starting, to give us a little bit of a chance to scout them. And you know, thankfully, and I'm hoping that I think Hagan Smith will not be available tomorrow, and so that's what I'm crossing my fingers as well.
Well, speaking of, Colin Fisher's been starting the midweek games, but he pitched yesterday several innings, and so I don't know if he'll start tomorrow or not. So I was just curious on how they'll let you know and when they'll let you know.
I think actually, Wes, word got to us. We've already exchanged, and I think they're going to go with Bybee.
Oh wow!
And we're going to, which I think is his first outing this year.
Yep.
Maybe coming off some arm stuff he was working through, and then we're going to go with an older guy, Austin Stubber, mm-hmm. one of our bullpen guys, mm-hmm. who's kind of been a Swiss Army knife for us, and that, you know, he's been a middle relief guy. He's closed games for us. We stretched him out at times, and so we're going with him just because he's an older, calmer presence that we want to make sure and get off to a good start and not create any innings via the walk or get sped up a little bit.
Coach, do you have a different philosophy when it comes to weekend games as opposed to some of these midweek games? What's your outlook on a series as opposed to just a midweek game?
Yes, I definitely, Joe. It starts with the pitching and how you – everything now. You know, what's different about the first 5 weeks for us, because we don't start conference until that fifth week, is all of the games early preseason matter the same, whether they be weekend or midweek. So you might – use your pitching differently on a Tuesday that might leave you shorthanded for a non-conference game Friday, but because they're both non-conference, then that's okay. But now that we're both in conference play, I definitely believe that no decisions will be made that will hurt the bullpen or hinder it going into Friday. And so you don't stretch a pitcher out too far so that you burn him, which is a term for he's not available for the next game or two, and you get him out and as quick as you can so that he's fresh for the weekend. And so that's why I think you'll see a combination of a lot of different arms maybe. I don't know their plan for Bybee, but maybe a lot of different arms for them. You also use Tuesday non-conference to get some guys some work who didn't throw in the weekend, or maybe a guy you're trying to make decisions about to see how he might help you in a certain role, like bringing him in to get a left-handed hitter out, or bringing him in a ground ball situation to see if he can get a ground ball or a strikeout. And then on the lineup side, maybe a guy who didn't get at bats during the weekend can get some at bats and keep him ready as a extra guy or pinch hitter, or you might change the DH or something like that. But, The midweek game purposes do change, at least in our opinion, a little bit as far as personnel. But we are absolutely trying to do everything we can to win those games as much as we are on Friday.
We're talking with Chris Curry. He's the head coach of the Little Rock Trojans. And, Coach, later on in the show, we got the new athletic director coming on. Frank Cuervo will join us. What are your thoughts on the new athletic director hire?
Yeah, I'm appreciative to the job that George Lee did for 4 years, bringing us through the COVID times and then moving us into the Ohio Valley, which I think, you know, was a good move for baseball especially. And so I was asked to be on the search committee. Didn't politic for it, or I didn't ask them for it, but they asked me to be on it, and so I was part of the process. And Frank just blew us away, the committee. And the way that he interviewed, his professionalism, the plan that he laid out for fundraising, which is key at Little Rock, and then also his leadership skills and plan for engaging the community. And the fact that he's already going to be on your show is a great thing. Thanks for doing that, guys. But Frank is a veteran of college athletics. You know, what I like selfishly, he walked on at Florida in the 90s to play baseball. So he's kind of a baseball guy. And he spent time at Missouri, at SEMO, at UAB, at I think New Mexico. So even though he's coming from Illinois, Chicago, his roots are kind of near here. And I'm excited to get going. And I think the community and you guys, the media, and I know our teams are going to see an immediate impact. And I also need to give a shout out to Neil Arisman and the wrestling team. What an unbelievable run and a great job that he did. National Coach of the Year, a couple of All-Americans, really awesome job.
So I can tell, Frank, it's safe to say he was your second choice?
No. Frank, for me, was the number one choice by far. By far. Good try, though. Good try.
Put you in a little hot water to start things off with the rocky relationship.
I appreciate that. Brand new boss. Yeah, no. Frank blew it out of the water in the interview, and the other folks that were part of the process agreed there wasn't much deliberation about, you know, the chancellor ultimately makes the decision, of course, but the committee makes their recommendation, and I think Frank won by a landslide.
Coach, thank you for your time, and congratulations on winning the first series against Morehead State, and best of luck to you the rest of the way. Well, and I mean, we'll talk to you before now and then, but good luck to you.
Thank you very much, Wes and Joe, and keep up the good work. Enjoy it.
All right. Take care. Chris Curry joining us on Out of Bounds. Excited for tomorrow. I know they're excited. Get to play Arkansas and go up to Fayetteville. Big crowd. Afternoon game. It'll be fun. It'll be a fun time. When we come back, let's talk a little bit more about the NCAA tournament. How about that?
Let's do it.
Okay. We'll do that. We'll take some more phone calls. Sorry we couldn't get to the previous caller, 661-1037. If you want to jump on here, we got an open segment now. Actually, the rest of the hour is open, 661-1037, third hour. Frank Cuervo will join us, the new athletic director at Little Rock. Joe Klein's coming in. So we'll have a busy third hour. If you want to jump in, talk a little sports with us, right now is the time, 661-1037. It's his Out of Bounds.
Join the guys Friday morning, bringing the mayhem to Fletcher, Chrysler, Dodge, Jeep, Ram, and Sherwood. Stop by or check out their selection of new and pre-owned vehicles at FletcherDeals.com.
This is SportsCenter.
Arkansas baseball won 2 out of 3 against Auburn this weekend. After winning Thursday night, they beat Auburn 6-5 on Friday night before falling to Auburn 8-6 in the series finale on Saturday. Coach Dave Van Horn recapped the series following Saturday's game.
I told them it was a great weekend. We won 2 out of 3 on the road against a ranked team, a team that was struggling. They were going to fight us till the end, and they did. And, you know, we were real close to sweeping them in their own park, but we didn't, but we could have. So maybe next time we will.
Arkansas baseball will be back on the diamond tomorrow as they host Little Rock for an in-state matchup. First pitch is set for 3. Coverage can be heard on 106.7 Buzz 2. I'm Christian Weaver with the Buzz Radio Network.
It's the Ranger Open House Sale through Monday at Bradford Marine and ATV at all 6 statewide locations. Last of the boat show deals, like the Ranger 520R with 250 horsepower Mercury with trailer and up to a $2,000 Bass Pro gift card and discounts up to $10,000 on select models. Or check out the SunTracker Sportfish 22, great for fishing and cruising with 115 horsepower Mercury outboard. Don't miss the Open House Sale today through April 1st at all Bradford Marine and ATV statewide locations. Your authorized Ranger and Tracker dealer.
Arkansas broadcast legend Craig O'Neill joins Morning Mayhem each week presented by Petty Jean Meats, locally owned and operated for 4 generations. With Petty Jean Meats, people always know where their meat is coming from, made right here in Arkansas.
Pizza's here.
Oh, great. I'd love some, but I'm worried about my stomach issues.
If you're worried about having diarrhea, gas, bloating, stomach pain, or loose, oily stools, it may not just be stomach issues. It could be a condition called exocrine pancreatic insufficiency, or EPI. With EPI, the pancreas doesn't release enough enzymes to break down food, but EPI is manageable. Use the symptom checker on identifyepi.com and talk to your doctor. That's identifyepi.com. Sponsored by AbbVie.
No matter how large or small your digging project may be, no matter how urban or rural, you must always call 811 before any digging project. 811 is our national one-call number, alerting your local utility companies to come out and mark any lines they have near your dig site. So before you do this or this, make sure you do this. For digging projects big or small, make the call to 811, brought to you by Common Ground Alliance.
Heartland Rehabilitation and Care Center in Benton proudly offers compassionate and loving care to our veterans, meeting the unique needs of every veteran who calls Heartland home. Visit HeartlandRehabCenter.com.
Sanders Ground Essentials presents Belinda Mayo when she joins Morning Mayhem each Thursday morning. Sanders Ground Essentials, where great lawns start today. On the web at SandersGround.com. It's Belinda Mayo each Thursday with Morning Mayhem on 103.7 The Buzz.
Riceland Foods in Stuttgart is hiring a shift supervisor, a plant engineer, plant electrician, I&E technician, and packaging tech. Riceland Foods company benefits include medical insurance with low premiums, free dental with medical enrollment, vision insurance with low premiums, free basic life insurance up to 3 times basic annual earning, voluntary term life, long-term disability, short-term disability, accident insurance, critical illness insurance, 401k with company match 4% of employees 5%, paid training programs, PTO, and paid holidays. Riceland Foods is hiring shift supervisor, a plant engineer, plant electrician, I&E technician, and packaging tech. Get all the information on these jobs and more at Riceland.com. Home to over 1,500 employees, Riceland has a position to match your unique skill set. With so many departments and positions available, the possibilities are endless. For more information on these jobs and more, go to Riceland.com. Riceland, a farmer-owned cooperative helping farmers feed the world.
It's not just about the size of the meat, it's about where you get it from. So get it from Hogg's Meat Market in North Little Rock. Hogg's Meat Market, the steak people. Weekend recap brought to you by Fleet Management Services, serving Central Arkansas for over 20 years. They're your small to mid-sized specialist. When you need someone to service your fleet and get your employees back on the road quick, call 501-375-3672.
Welcome back to Out of Bounds. Wes Moore, Joe Franklin. Glad you're with us. You can get in here now at 661-1037. 661-1037. Same number for the Southern Structural Solutions text line. Let's get to Shane in Benton. Shane, welcome into Out of Bounds.
Yeah, I'm going to talk a little bit baseball a little bit. I'm kind of concerned. Our bullpen's been so good, but on Saturday, I was kind of disappointed, and I hope it ain't a problem that's going to linger. We'll see what you guys think.
Yeah, Saturday was a bad day for the bullpen. I mean, they had a nice lead up 4-0, 4-1, then 5-1, and the bullpen just kind of blew it. Mason Molina had to come out, and I thought Cooper Dossett. And look, Coach Van Horn's the GOAT. He's great at what he does, but I wish he'd had a little longer leash with Cooper Dossett, or as they kept calling him all weekend, Dossett. That drove me up the wall. Cooper Dossett came in and gave up a hit, and then it was like a ground ball, and he slipped right, and he fell down, and it wasn't like his fault. And so I was like, he's going to be fine. Keep him in there. But they had the short leash on him, and then Gackle came in, and Gackle just couldn't locate. He walked a couple of guys. That slider, he couldn't throw the slider for a strike, and then they started sitting on his fastball, and it was just a – it got a little dicey, and so they had to get Gackle out of there because he couldn't throw a strike, and went to Colin Fisher, and he's been so good, but then he gave up the opposite field home run.
Shane, if it becomes a pattern, then it could be something to be concerned about. But in a 3-game series, sometimes in the last game, you're going to have these types of games, especially when it comes to the bullpen.
The concerning thing would
be
the walks.
I hope they've been home, don't give up on Gackle or Fisher.
No, not at all. I mean, Gabe Gackle is going to be their closer, and that's why he brought him in early, because it was such a key moment. And for the first time, we saw him struggle with the bases loaded. So many times he's been able to get out of a bases loaded jam, and he see you later, Shane. Like I said, it was pretty simple. He just couldn't locate the slider, and that's one of his best pitches, that and his fastball. But then once he couldn't throw the slider for a strike, they just started sitting on his fastball. And they would foul it off, and he'd have to throw a slider and ball four. Happened a couple of times, so they had to get him out. And looked like Colin Fisher. You know, he got the swinging strike for strike two, out two, and I thought he was going to get out of the jam, got ahead of their big guy for Auburn. What was his name? Cooper McMurray. And he just left one over the plate. He went opposite field with it over the wall for the home run to give Auburn the lead. And that one hurt. But, no, I don't think he's going to lose faith in those guys. I think Joe nailed it. If it becomes a trend, we'll worry about it. But this is a hiccup. Let's just call it a hiccup. Hey, and don't forget, Auburn's good. I mean, they're a top 25 team for a reason. They can hit because they're a good hitting team. And Arkansas's pitchers did a very good job of slowing them down the first couple of games and for the first couple of innings. I mean, Auburn didn't score until the fifth, and then they added that sixth spot in the sixth. That's a good team. And they were in the College World Series last year. They're getting their arms straightened out, and they're going to have better starting pitchers and pitching. I just tip my cap to them.
Razorbacks aren't going to win every game, and they're going to have some bumps along the way. So you just know that comes with a long season in college baseball.
Yeah, that one kind of hurt, though, Joe. I'll be honest. When you're up 4-0 with the pitching that Arkansas has and the bullpen, and then Auburn scored to make it 4-1, and Arkansas responded right back and made it 5-1. I was like, man, they're going to the bottom of the sixth. I like their chances here. And then bam, 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 walk, 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 bam, home run. And that crowd got into it. Auburn got the momentum. And I give Arkansas credit. They came back and scored a run in the seventh and really had a chance to add to it and maybe tie it up. But Auburn then gets the home run. For the first time, I believe for the first time, an over hit on the weekend, Joe. It was 13.5 on Sunday. The under hit Thursday and Friday. Saturday, it was 13.5. And I thought it was looking good until Auburn put up a six spot. And it was still hanging by a thread. I was like, I'm sitting there, I'm like, I'm in a good situation. If Arkansas scores and wins and I lose my bet, I'm happy. If it stays like this and Arkansas loses but I win my bet, I'm happy. And Auburn hits a solo home run in the eighth inning for an insurance run. I lost the bet, and they lost the game. And I was like, well, that sucks. That's not the way I was hoping it would go. But, yeah, for the first time on the weekend, the over hit with Arkansas. And it was one of the higher ones at 13.5. But, you know, Sundays are usually higher scoring games because of the pitching is – you've used your best bullpen options. And, hey, let's don't forget Gabe Gackle pitched on Thursday. It was only an inning. It was a short inning. But, you know, maybe he's not one of those guys yet that can turn around and pitch twice in a weekend. At least he didn't indicate he could this time. But I know they're going to want him to pitch more than once in a weekend in the future.
That's why Shane was concerned, and he doesn't want this guy to be given up on.
No. Won't be. He's too good. I mean, Gabe Gackle's he could be your ace next year. I mean, Hagan Smith gone, Brady Tiger gone, Mason Molina gone. He very well could be the Friday night guy next year. That's how good he is.
Yeah.
They're not going to give up on him.
Well, he's talking about the role right now, not necessarily looking forward.
No. Nobody's perfect. They'll be fine. He'll be fine. 661-1037. Let's go over to the Southern Structural Solutions text line. See what we got over there. Drew says, that is correct, Joe. It will be that way forever. Not sure what he was talking about. JK says, interesting, the Ohtani saga, what will be revealed on gambling issues? Yeah, that is going to be something worth watching and keeping an eye on.
Well, the narrative that's been put out there for now is that
– wasn't him.
Yeah, and the guy was using his account and using funds from his account to make these wagers. So – will they continue to go, even though they are taking a a deep dive and investigation into it. Is Ohtani going to come out clean on this?
From the 501, tell us how valuable Big Will Mack is and has been. That's Mike and Bryant. Will McIntyre's been awesome. I mean, we saw it Thursday night, came in for Hagen Smith, pitched two innings, and I thought they may let him pitch the ninth also, but they went with Gackle, and he had a perfect ninth. And then McIntyre came back out, closed it on Friday night, came up huge Friday night, and then Saturday we didn't see him. And then Mike and Bryant follows it up. Should they go to him in relief 3 days in a row? Or keep him healthy and ready to go when the postseason starts.
Keep him healthy.
Yep, you nailed that. McIntyre is one of those guys, and that's proven. He's said it. The more, the better. He likes to pitch multiple times on a weekend. 3 days in a row is probably asking a little too much, especially since he went two innings, but they were pretty quick innings for him on Thursday night and Friday. High-stress situation. But I bet if he was asked, McIntyre would have been ready to go on Saturday, but I think that was probably a coach's decision. You've pitched enough. Yeah, it's a long season. And we're already seeing that with Hagen. Hagen Smith went six innings and didn't throw a lot of pitches. You know, the whole issue Thursday night was with the outfielder when he dropped that ball up against the wall and then was second and third and one out. He got the strikeout and the ground out to finish the inning. And Dave Van Horn said after the game, that was it. He was done. That was a high-stress situation. If they would have played the ball cleanly and caught that for the out two, and then he gets the third out, no problem. He was going to come back out in the seventh. But even with all that, I thought he was coming back out for the seventh because he hadn't thrown that, you know, 80-something pitches, 86. He should be around 100 now, 105. But they're playing it safe with him, and I'm okay with that because the goal isn't to, you know, right now it's June, July, College World Series. That's the goal. And you want a Hagen Smith that's not worn out for the regional, super regionals, and the College World Series.
You even have to manage it then. You mm-hmm. get to the postseason, you get to the College World Series where you want to be. When these situations come up, you still have to manage it.
Yeah,
and that's why coaching matters.
Yeah, especially in the College World Series where you're thinking, well, we can turn around and pitch him a little bit later. If got a lead, feeling good, all right, let's go ahead and take him out after the sixth inning. And let's let the bullpen that we trust finish this out so he'll be ready to go the next time we need him at the College World Series. You're exactly right. They're always keeping an eye on that pitch count and the number of innings that he's throwing, and stressful innings at times. That was from Stewart. We're going to see what it looks like. My radar shows it getting past Brian around 5:30. Oh, that's Stewart talking about the weather. Yeah, I was just looking at my app, and that line of storms is getting close to Little Rock and will probably hit here in the next 15 minutes. And it's going to be a kind of strong thunderstorms, but I haven't seen any warnings or anything. I think it's just going to be a lot of high winds and heavy rain, and it's going to be nasty for a couple hours in Little Rock and Central Arkansas. So just be weather aware the next couple of hours. Let's go to Savage. He's in Cabot. What's up, Savage?
What's going on, fellas? Doing all right?
Good, good.
Hey, guys, just give me your opinion on this, Wes and Joe. Me and a couple guys at work are talking about Angel Reese and what kind of player she is. And I'm not going to give you my opinion on it, but I just want to get yours. Do y'all think she's classy, sportsman? What you think, you know, as far as watching her personal game, how she acts on the court, the press conference? What's your thoughts on that? I'm going to get off here. Appreciate it.
Okay. She's a big-time trash talker. Yeah. And that's something that is, you know, you take it or leave it, but that's something that's always been a part of the game, basketball or sports in general. And sometimes it's needed, those big personalities like that. But on the court, she's a big-time trash talker. And then even some news that came out with her recently where she addressed earlier in the season talking about being suspended, that she had low GPA, and that she was being held out. She said she was actually pregnant, and so that's why she wasn't playing at the beginning of the season. Hmm. And it's even interesting with her that she gave out those details and she went that in-depth to give out some personal information. But you can see that some of the comments that she hears, it's starting to get to her simply because she came out with something very personal that she didn't have to release for everybody to know.
I think she gets to that line, and sometimes she tiptoes over the line for some, and for others, they like it. The trash talk, the confidence slash cockiness. It seems to be okay in men's sports, but for some people, they look down on it for women's sports, that they shouldn't be like that. But I enjoy it. It brings – I like the personality, but I think there are things that – I saw it pointed out on Twitter, her – just she got upset, and she had kind of a negative attitude in the game against – was it Middle Tennessee State the other day? And just wasn't really kind of hustling and loafing down the court. And then she came down and kind of pushed a girl down on the floor. And she gets that spotlight because of her personality. No one would have noticed it.
They know who she is, and so sometimes they are going to try to push her to the point because they know that she is a really good player, and that team is stacked with talent. So anything they can do to try to take away from that. Players are going to try her at times because they know how she is on the court.
You know, and when that motor's running high and you're one of those type of players, you know, sometimes you can kind of poke them a little bit, you know, and get them out of their game by pushing them over their limit and get them a little upset. Sometimes it backfires and gets them going, but sometimes it does. It'll throw them off their game.
And that's her game in a nutshell, but not that's why, you know, she's on the court to do certain things like that, but – she's always going to get engaged in trash talk. If somebody is saying something to her, she's never going to back down. That's going to make her go even harder.
I tell you what, I watch LSU basketball because of her. That says something, right?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Lowe said, Lorenzo Robinson chiming in. Nothing wrong with Angel Reese's attitude on the court. Men can do it all the time. Yep, that's what I just said.
Absolutely right.
Any update on the Musselman rumors? Drewski from Hot Springs. Kind of quieting down a little bit. I heard encouraging news over the weekend, but I was talking with someone earlier today, and they said they were hearing it outside circles that maybe things are heating back up. I don't know. I all I know is he's recruiting. He's got one of the transfer guys coming in for an official visit tomorrow. So, I mean, he's working as if right now he's going to be the head coach at Arkansas, trying to bring in some of these transfers.
Well, the biggest domino in the coaching search has already fallen in Dusty May, and he's going to Michigan. So he's one of those guys that was connected to many of the jobs that were open. And some of the conversations that you heard where Coach Muss's name is coming up, Dusty May was connected there. He's already filled a job. He's going to Michigan. Yep.
Louisville's still open, though. Yeah, I was reading an article over the weekend about some of the guys they may target, and Musselman's name was not mentioned. It was some other smaller names that maybe if you're a big basketball fan, you know these guys, up-and-coming guys, but I didn't know who they were. So it made me feel better, and it was a Louisville newspaper that wrote the article, so I felt like they knew or had an inside connection on some of the targets that Louisville was looking at. And at least Musselman's name wasn't mentioned there. So I took that as a positive. Rumors, Joey says. That's the key word. Yep, nothing substantial out there. Just a lot of smoke. But sometimes when there's a lot of smoke, you know there's a fire somewhere. And JW chimes in. What is Bobby Petrino's most valuable asset? Is it pregame, getting ready for the opponent, halftime adjustments, evaluating talent? Because we were lacking in all of it last year. Man, when I think of Bobby Petrino, I think of scheming. Like his offense, he knows how to scheme a play to get guys open. I just think X's and O's, to me, that's the first thing that comes to my mind. Now, I think back to that Texas A&M game years ago when they were behind big at the half. The halftime adjustment he made was simple. They came out and just ran the ball. They ran it and ran it and ran it. And then it opened up the passing game and they – came all the way back and won. So
he took over the defense also, which is something he's not known for. But he makes quarterbacks look better. Yep. That's the first thing that comes to mind. You know, you can have what some people would consider a game manager, but because of the scheme, as you mentioned, Bobby Petrino, he can work with different quarterbacks of different talent levels, and the ones that are lower on that scale, he can make them look better.
I think he's good at preparing a quarterback. A coach, a teacher, you know, he gets that quarterback ready to succeed. He puts them in that situation. Thanks, JW. That'll do it for this segment, 661-1037. If you want to chime in for our last segment of the hour, Joe Klein's coming up. We also have the new AD of the Little Rock Trojans, Frank Cuervo joining us at 3:05, top of the next hour. Stick around. It's Out of Bounds.
Hey everyone, this is Heather Baker, president and publisher of AY Media Group here in Arkansas. We publish two of the biggest and most widely read magazines in the entire state, AY Magazine and Arkansas Money and Politics. At AY and Arkansas Money and Politics, we keep you up to date on all the news you need to know and the stories you want to hear. Visit us online at aymag.com and armoneyandpolitics.com to see for yourself. Now, more than ever, it is important to be mindful of where you get your news and support your local businesses. With AY Media Group, you get the best of both worlds.
This is Pat Bradley for Brewskies. Everybody thinks about Brewskies for watching sports or having a great night out. But what about Brewskies for lunch? Both locations open at 11 a.m. 7 days a week with all your pub grub favorites, friendly service, kitchen all-stars are ready to serve you. Or, if you're not in a hurry, have a couple cold ones. Happy hour starts at 11 a.m. too. Brewskies, you're home for lunch, happy hour, and late night now with two locations, downtown Little Rock and the brand new location in Lakewood Village, North Little Rock.
This is the Pigskin Preacher, bringing you the word. In 1983, Bonnie Tyler sang, "Turn around, every now and then I get a little bit lonely and you're never coming round. Turn around, every now and then I get a little bit tired of listening to the sound of my..." Tears. Turn around, bright eyes. Indeed. Now, right now, some of you are thinking of the Dan Band and laughing. 40 years later, Arkansas is ground zero for eclipse viewing. Come by Double B's and purchase your eclipse viewing glasses so you can watch safely without going blind. Like everything else, Double B's has deals on everything you need, from eclipse glasses to drinks to toast the eclipse to other things to cheer you up if you're going through a total eclipse of the heart. Double B's. It's where you gas it, grab it, and go. That's Double B's.
Willie D's Rock and Roll Piano Bar, open every Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. Cold drinks and dueling pianos. Deep Nightclub downstairs hosts karaoke on Tuesdays and DJ spin on Friday and Saturday nights. Visit WillieD'sPianoBar.com. Come and get your Willie on.
Southern Bank presents Family Feud on 103.7 The Buzz. Tune in to Morning Mayhem on Tuesday mornings for your chance to play with Justin Moore, David, and Roger. Family Feud on Morning Mayhem brought to you by Southern Bank. Bankwithsouthern.com.
What do you do when the power goes out? Well, now you can do anything you want when you purchase a Generac home standby generator from Generator Supercenter of Little Rock. Come visit the experts at Central Arkansas's only generator showroom located on Chenal Parkway in West Little Rock. We offer a turnkey solution, financing, and 24/7 service. Visit our website for more info at GeneratorSupercenterOfLittleRock.com. The standby power people.
Prescriptions require an online consultation with a healthcare provider who will determine if appropriate. Restrictions apply. See website for details and important safety information. Subscription required. Price varies based on product and subscription plan.
Hey guys, did you know there's a generic form of Viagra that works just the same but is 95% cheaper? And you can get it online at hims.com/joy. Through Hims, you'll get a free medical consultation to determine the ED medication that's best for you. Discreet shipping if prescribed, a 100% online process, and a range of treatment options, including trusted generic alternatives to the name brands, at up to 95% off. ED is personal, and at Hims, so is treating it. Just go to hims.com/joy and get connected to a licensed medical provider online for free. With zero copay, no expensive appointments, and no awkward face-to-face conversations. To start your free online visit, you need to go to this exclusive address, hims.com/joy. That's hims.com/joy for your free online visit, hims.com/joy.
There's only one place to stop for the best in meats in Central Arkansas. It's Hogg's Meat Market. Check out their monthly package deals of the best meats online at hogsmeatmarket.com. Hogg's Meat Market, the steak people.
Make me swim, make me harder, make me lose my breath, make me water, make me swim, make me harder. Make me lose my breath. Make me water.
Weekend recap brought to you by
Fleet Management Services, serving Central Arkansas for over 20 years. They're your small to mid-sized specialist. When you need someone to service your fleet and get your employees back on the road quick, call 501-375-3672.
Fun weekend watching the NCAA tournament and some of the big games, getting ready for another big weekend, hopefully Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I thought the A&M Houston game was absolutely fantastic last night. What a great comeback by the Aggies to force overtime. And then Houston, says a lot about Houston to withstand that comeback, the momentum the A&M had, and then to go to overtime and win that game.
Kelvin, that was a prize fight. How did you come out on top?
You know, then the last 2 minutes was Murphy's Law. You know, we kept missing some free throws. The ball was bounced all over the place. They didn't miss a three, and they didn't make an easy one. They were all hard threes. Somebody said, well, how did they come back? We missed some free throws. They kept fighting for rebounds, kicking them out, making threes.
Talk about also the resiliency of your team when you look at this whole unit so connected down the stretch.
Well, when we got to the huddle to start this overtime, I said, we've been here before, Baylor.
Yeah.
Because we're up big in the Baylor game. They came back, tied it, we go to overtime. And against all odds, on the road, against a really good Baylor team, great fans, we find a way to win. Same thing today. But I think when you have a culture that's built on togetherness and work, playing together was not good enough tonight, John. We had to play for each other.
I saw, too, they were talking about Reggie Chaney. They had the patch on their jerseys, and he said during the huddle, basically, you know, what would Reggie do in this situation and challenge the guys to be like Reggie Chaney? I thought that was pretty cool, too.
Yeah, that is. It's really awesome. They dedicated their season to him.
Next up for Houston, Duke. Great matchup in the Sweet 16. 1-4. Tell you what, I was impressed with Duke and the way they just manhandled James Madison. I was rooting for James Madison out of the Sun Belt. Watched them beat A-State. Man, they got a good team. And James Madison showed it in the first round, beating Wisconsin. And I thought they had a chance against Duke. Duke came out right away and just said, uh-uh, not today. No upset story here. Your run ends after one victory.
Every team wants to play their best game against Duke because of the name on the jersey.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's going to be fun. Houston-Duke, that's a good matchup. That may be, looking at my bracket, that may be the one I'm most looking forward to. Tennessee Creighton will be great. North Carolina, Alabama. That's fun. That's a good 1-4. Illinois, Iowa State. All right. No, I think Houston Duke.
3.
Yeah, that may be the best one. All right, we'll talk more basketball next with Joe Klein. Also, we'll visit with the new athletic director at the Little Rock with the Little Rock Trojans. Frank Cuervo joins us when we come back. Stick around. It's Out of Bounds.
Roger, did you know that Oaklawn Sports is the mobile app that lets you bet anywhere in Arkansas?
Anywhere. So I can bet the over when I'm in Dover.
Indeed you can.
I can take the underdog in Dogtown.
Absolutely.
You're telling me I can bet on the pigskin and piggot?
Yep.
Hoops and Humnote, baseball and bauxite, long shots and Lavaca?
All of the above.
Anywhere, huh?
Anywhere.
Nice.
Easy to use and even easier to fund. Bet with confidence. Bet with Oaklawn Sports. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-522-4700.
Through the end of March, the deals could not be hotter at Arch Marine in North Little Rock. Ready for this? The ever-so-popular G3 boats with rebates up to $3,000 off already discounted 2022 and 23 models. The deals are hot, hot, hot at Arch Marine in North Little Rock. Come see us.
Hey! What a week this is going to be.
Oh, dude, we start out on the road tomorrow in North Little Rock at Bradford Marine.
Yeah, I got Rick Schaefer, John Daly, Peyton Stovall, just to name a few.
That's a huge show in itself, not to mention the big specials going on at Bradford Marine tomorrow.
.1037 The Buzz.
By the way, you know, when you're telling these little stories, here's a good idea. Have a point. It makes it so much more interesting for the listener.
KABZ Little Rock. Buzz News with Channel 7's Cassandra Webb.
In Hot Springs, police are continuing their investigation after one person was killed and two others were injured in a shooting. Police were called to the 200 block of Beard Street Friday afternoon. They found a pair of 20-year-olds shot inside a car. The driver, identified as Adriana Howell, was pronounced dead on the scene. The other victim was injured and taken to the hospital. Police then found a third victim on North Patterson Street shot in the leg. That victim was taken to the hospital for treatment. If you know anything about what happened, call the Hot Springs Police. The Democratic race for Justice of the Peace District 9 between incumbent Judy Green and Tina Renee Ward is yet to be settled. Polls will open from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. tomorrow at the Pulaski County Regional Building, D. Brown Library, and Glenview Community Center. Anyone who lives in District 9 and voted in the Democratic primary or cast a nonpartisan ballot can vote. Absentee ballots must be turned in no later than 7:30 on the night of the election. From the Channel 7 Newsroom, I'm Cassandra Webb.
Weather from the Fletcher Weather Center with Channel 7's Melinda Mayo.
Showers and thunderstorms increasing during the day. Overall, the severe weather threat is low, but there could be some gusty severe winds, and even an isolated tornado or two cannot be ruled out, especially across southeastern Arkansas. From the Channel 7 Weather Center, I'm meteorologist Melinda Mayo.
Fletcher Dodge wants to buy your car. We'll buy any make or model, and we'll pay you more than anyone else. Please, turn your old car into cash at Fletcher Dodge in Sherwood.
It's grass cutting time, which means it's also time for the annual Gravely Mowers Spring Tour, which Morning Mayhem will be kicking off at Triple C Sales and Service in Conway this Thursday morning, where you can take advantage of their special Mow the Distance sales event and save up to 25% off retail price. So join David and Roger at Triple C in Conway this Thursday morning.
Start spring in style, comfort, and power behind the wheel of a brand new 2024 Chevy Silverado. Guatney Chevrolet has interest rates as low as 2.9% for 72 months on Silverado pickup trucks. Spend less money and get more out of your drive at Guatney Chevrolet. Head to 1301 T.P. White Drive in Jacksonville to take advantage of fantastic interest rates on new Chevy Silverados. Chevrolet, together, let's drive. 2.9% APR for 72 months. Must finance with GM Financial. Some customers may not qualify. Not available with lease and some other offers. Take new retail delivery by April 30th, 2024.
Now's the time to get a great deal on proven Kubota farming equipment. Tractors that are adaptable, versatile, and rated number one in durability and owner experience. Hay tools that are backed by a two-year warranty. And durable Sidekick utility vehicles and SVL track loaders. Right now, bring home select Kubota equipment for zero down, 0% APR for up to 48 months, now through March 31st. Visit KubotaUSA.com for full details. Hennard Foothills Equipment, South Main Street in Searcy. Your hometown Kubota dealer, no matter where you live.
Here's another remarkable success story from QC Kinetics. This one from Chad, who hurt his knee at the gym one day, and it just kept on hurting for months.
From my high school football and wrestling days, I already had a little bit of damage in there, but this just sent it over the edge.
Chad tried traditional treatments with no improvement. When he turned to the non-surgical regenerative treatments at QC Kinetics.
It was really fascinating how they did their work, and the science behind it was very intriguing, and it works. Extracting the cure out of my own body blew my mind. It's like I'm brand new again. It was fantastic.
That's because the QC Kinetics natural biologic treatments use your body's own healing power to restore damaged tissue in your hips, shoulders, back, and knees, providing long-lasting relief.
Now I'm back at the gym. I'm 100%, feeling great.
If you're tired of suffering with pain from arthritis or injury, call QC Kinetics now for a free consultation.
Call QC Kinetics, 501-222-8440. That's 501-222-8440. 501-222-8440.
Take your yard up to the next level with the Caddy's Touch Landscaping. Josh Dickinson is a former PGA Tour caddy, and his landscape designs are inspired by some of the most beautiful golf courses around the world. Call Josh at 501-794-2770 for all of your landscaping needs. Flower beds a mess? Josh's crew can give your home the curb appeal you've always wanted. The Caddy's Touch Landscaping also installs French drains, retaining walls, and they'll even take care of your irrigation maintenance needs. The Caddy's Touch Landscaping. Call today, 501-794-2770.
This is Pat Bradley. At River City Flooring Maumelle, March Madness is here. They have luxury vinyl plank in a wide array of colors with 20 mil wear layer for just $2.49 per square foot. Waterproof laminate for $1.49 a square foot. And don't forget they have tile, the best in the business. Beautiful Calcutta tile for $2.50 per square foot. As always, you can get 0% financing for up to 3 years with qualifying credit. River City Flooring Maumelle, where you're always the winner.
Do you have trouble getting in and out of the bathtub? Are you afraid you'll slip and fall entering or exiting a tub? Safe Step walk-in tubs can transform your bathtub from an area of concern to a calming refuge. Call them today at 1-800-731-4558 and save $1,600. Safe Step walk-in tubs and showers are proudly made in Tennessee and offer an ultra-low step-in, avoiding that difficult climb over a traditional bathtub wall. They also offer a variety of therapeutic benefits that may help soothe your aching muscles and joints, increasing your mobility, boosting your energy, and improving your sleep. Safe Step walk-in tubs are designed to easily fit your existing tub space and are often installed in as little as one day. Just dial 1-800-731-4558 today to save $1,600 and receive a free shower package. That's 1-800-731-4558 for a free no-obligation consultation and to save $1,600. Safe Step walk-in tubs. Safety never felt so good.
Live from the Hogs Meat Market Studios, this is Out of Bounds with Wes Moore and Joe Franklin on 103.7 The Buzz.
My left stroke just went viral.
Right stroke put a baby in a spiral.
Back at it. Glad you're with us. Out of Bounds, Wes Moore, Joe Franklin. Hour number three. We got Joe Klein with us here in a few minutes. We're going to get the new Little Rock Athletic Director on the phone. Frank Cuervo will join us. And congratulations to Arkansas State. They win this afternoon. They're on their way to the semifinals. They knocked off Montana 74-61. Got a little nervous. You know, they had a 19-point lead at the half, and every time I looked up, it got a little closer. It was a 5-point game late, and I thought, oh, no, I hope they're not going to blow it. But then they rallied down the stretch. They win by 13, 74-61. That's just the third time in program history that Arkansas State has 20 wins. They'll be back at it tomorrow in the semifinals at 6 o'clock. A little A-State update. How about a Little Rock Trojans update? They have a new athletic director, and Frank Cuervo joins us now. Welcome into Out of Bounds, and Frank, welcome to Little Rock. Congratulations.
Thank you, gentlemen. It's great to be with you. I appreciate you having me.
No, we're excited to have you on and talk a little Little Rock athletics and your vision for Little Rock Trojans. We cover a lot. The basketball team was rolling with Daryl Walker, and we just had Coach Curry on, talk a little baseball, and he was telling us you were a slam dunk hire. He was part of the committee, and he was excited. I don't know if he's already kissing up to the new boss, but he said this was a no-brainer.
Well, Chris is very kind, and of course he's one of an elite group of head coaches that we have here at Little Rock. You know, I look at the success that the program's had recently and this group of colleagues of head coaches that I inherit, and it's kind of an embarrassment of riches, to be honest with you. You know, you talk about Chris Curry and a team that's picked to win the OVC and has competed at a high level for so long. I've got a national coach of the year in Neil Arisman and the incredible story of the Little Rock wrestling program that's going on. I've got a men's basketball head coach who just won the OVC, and I've got a women's coach who was right there competing for it, and of course his name's on the floor, so that's pretty good. They don't normally put your name on the court unless you can coach a little bit. So I'm just incredibly blessed to have this opportunity. Was so excited as I learned more and more about the UA Little Rock program. I could tell that this is a program that matters to people. People care about what happens with the Trojans. And for someone in my line of work, when you see that type of scenario, it creates a very, very appealing opportunity. So my family and I couldn't be more excited to be headed down to Arkansas and to Little Rock.
Frank, give us and the people of Little Rock, tell us a little more about you and your background.
Well, you know, I'm from the South. I grew up in Florida, and I was a baseball player growing up. Now, make no mistake about it, I was not an immensely talented student athlete by any stretch of the imagination. You know, we're in March Madness now, so you know you see the 12th or the 13th guy at the end of the bench who's kind of getting excited and waving the towel and getting his teammates into it. Well, I was the equivalent of that on the baseball field. So I loved being around it, and I loved the game and what it taught. But there were certainly those far, far more talented than I was. But, you know, what I did learn was how to try to make myself indispensable to an organization and create value. And hopefully that's what I'm able to do at Little Rock. You know, I've been fortunate to work in college athletics for over a quarter century now. And I love this business. You know, the idea that you get to not only go to work and be in the athletics environment every day, but you get to compete to try to win championships and make yourself better. And you get to have such a positive impact on the lives of so many young men and women, some of whom may not otherwise have the opportunity to go to college and improve themselves. You know, I'm stealing money. I haven't worked a day in my career, and I'm fortunate that I'll have this opportunity to lead the Little Rock program.
Did you also go into coaching? How did you make the transition from coaching to athletics?
Well, you know, there was a minute there where I thought about going into coaching baseball, and as I joke with Chris Curry, then I thought better of it, right? You know, having your lifeline or your livelihood on the line every night with one pitch or one hit. So, you know, I quickly realized, and a couple of my mentors in life showed me that there was a path to be able to work in this business. You know, a guy named Jeremy Foley, the former athletics director at the University of Florida, and a few others really helped show me that there was a path to be able to develop a career in this business. And like I said, I'm fortunate. I haven't worked a day in my life. This has all been an incredible pleasure.
We're talking with Little Rock's new athletic director, Frank Cuervo. He joins us on Out of Bounds. Frank, what do you want to get done at Little Rock? What's your goal?
Well, you know, I could tell very early on that this is an exceptional institution with an exceptional athletics program. You know, we've got 16 sports with 275 of the best and brightest student athletes around. So that was really appealing to me right off the bat. You know, our aim is to look to go out and build a championship caliber program. You know, one that really embraces comprehensive excellence. We want to be great in everything we do, just like everyone across the UA Little Rock campus wants to be great at everything they do. You know, the way for us it manifests itself is that, you know, first and foremost, we want to be great and competitive in the classroom. You know, we want our student athletes to go to class, to earn degrees and go out and prepare to be, you know, husbands and wives, mothers and fathers and productive members of society. Which dovetails into the second piece is that, you know, we want to contribute to our communities. You know, we ask a lot of the people of Little Rock and Central Arkansas to support us, whether it's with their time, with their treasure, with their talents. So we ask a lot of them. And so in turn, I think it's important for us to pour into the community that you see our coaches and you see our student athletes and those associated with the program out in the community making a difference, whether that's in the schools or in community programming. Yeah, we want to be very visible. If we're asking you to come into our house, we want to be able to come into yours and add value as well. And then finally, and it's certainly not the last item, but the final one I'll mention is that we want to compete. You know, we want to go out and win championships in the OVC, and we want to go out and compete on the national level. You know, the last weekend here, there's no greater sign of what an athletics program can do for an institution than what happens with March Madness. You know, you have institutions out there that maybe some folks aren't terribly familiar with, but all of a sudden they're a part of that field of 68. People know who they are. They go out and they investigate and they find out more about them. So, you know, we want to be able to try to bring that pride and distinction for UA Little Rock through Trojan Athletics, and I think there's a great platform for us to be able to do that. This program matters to people. It's the people of Central Arkansas's program, and we very much want to make sure that comes through in everything we do.
Are you already here, or are you still in the process of making the transition and making the move?
I will be in Little Rock very soon. As a matter of fact, I come down tomorrow. Should be in town by midday or just a little bit after, and going to do a little house hunting, a little touring, and get to know the area and meet with some of our coaches and staff over the next few days. On Wednesday morning, there'll be a kind of a public introduction, an opportunity to get to, folks to hear from me and meet it, most importantly, to get to meet the people of the area. I believe that's at 11 a.m. on Wednesday on campus at the Alumni Center. And then I'll be there Thursday again to meet with meet with our coaches and our student athletes and start to get to know the program a little bit. Then I'll come back here to suburban Chicago, get things wrapped up, and I'll be back on the ground in Little Rock mid-April, April 15th, I believe, to get to work full time.
Little Rock's new director of athletics, Frank Cuervo, joins us on Out of Bounds. Frank, what are your thoughts on NIL? Because that's such a hot topic with college sports, and then you get to a mid-major like this, and we see it. Players, good players, leaving and going somewhere else, maybe a bigger school where they can get a little NIL money. What can you do at Little Rock to maybe keep some of those players from leaving?
Certainly. Well, I'll tell you today what I've told many of the supporters at my current institution at UIC in Chicago, and is that there's no more important way in which someone can support the athletics program today than by contributing to name, image, and likeness NIL efforts. It's become one of the single greatest determinants to being able to go out and attract and recruit the top type of talent that you want to have within your programs that's going to allow us to experience the type of success that we all want. And so it's critically important that we have a well-developed strategy that we're able to work with our partners, engage them to execute. I'll tell you, it's been an interesting time in the world of college athletics. Somebody said to me the other day that there has not been more disruption in the collegiate athletics industry since 50 years ago when Title IX came into law. And that changed the entire complexion of what college athletics looked like because it created opportunities for women in athletics. And that's been phenomenal. It's been incredible. You look at the NCAA Women's College Basketball Tournament going on right now. It's never been on a higher profile, never been bigger than it is now. You look at the softball championship that's held in Oklahoma City every year. That's become a marquee event. Or the volleyball Final Four, where they're packing arenas with 24,000 people to watch two volleyball matches. So that was an incredible inflection point, an incredible point of disruption that led to so many great things over the last five decades. I'm optimistic that this juncture, while we still have some things to figure out, but this juncture in college athletics will lead to the same type of development and some of the same positive outcomes that did over 50 years ago. So no doubt it's very much at the forefront of what we do. If we don't get our heads around it and plan for it, we're going to be passed. And certainly one of the hallmarks we want to be known for here is being in a leadership position, being at the forefront and taking a leadership position on issues. And certainly name, image, and likeness is going to be among them.
I'm curious, from the outside, looking in at Little Rock, what was Little Rock's reputation? What is Little Rock, or the University of Arkansas Little Rock, the Little Rock Athletic Department, what are they known for from the outside?
Well, I think it's known as a program that competes top to bottom, really embraces that concept of comprehensive excellence that I talked about before. And, you look here just over the last several weeks to a month and what better representation? You've got, wrestlers going to the national meet and crowning all Americans for the first time in program history. You've got track and field teams that are going out and winning championships and finishing second at a conference meet. You've got a men's basketball program that's winning a conference title and a women's program that has won umpteen number of conference titles, competing and being right there in the hunt for a championship. And then fast forward, you got a baseball program that's not only picked to win the Sun Belt, but went out and took two or three games from the team that picked to finish second. So I think that's very much the persona nationwide, that Little Rock is a program that that embraces that idea of being great at everything it does. It's in a fantastic area, a great area, a great region from which to recruit student athletes. I think certainly there's a growing reputation of a program that has incredible head coaches. And, you know, I don't want to take that for granted. We want to work hard to keep the Neil Arismans and others in Little Rock. That's important. You know, we want to make sure that those head coaches are, you know, they're working with our student athletes, and those 275 student athletes are the most precious resource we have. If we didn't have them, I wouldn't have a job, right? I wouldn't be coming to Little Rock, and we'd be talking about something else right now. So keeping those head coaches in place is key. So I think Little Rock's a program that has a great reputation and one that we can continue to build on, particularly at the national level as we go along.
Frank, it's been a pleasure. Congratulations on the new job, and look forward to working with you over the next decade or however long. Appreciate your time.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much. I appreciate you having me. And let me just say one final thing. I really look forward to you know, my family and I, my wife, Michelle, my 10-year-old son, Nathan, you know, becoming ingrained in the community. And certainly we want to invite you into our house to be a part of Trojan Athletics, but hopefully you'll invite me into yours to be able to get a view into your world. We've got a lot of great partners out there, and we want to make sure that we're building strong relationships across the board. So can't wait to be there. Incredibly excited about the opportunity.
Look forward to meeting you. Thanks, Frank. Take care. Have a safe trip down.
Thanks, guys. Have a great day. Take care. Go Trojan.
Frank Cuervo joining us on Out of Bounds. Joe Klein is also in the studio, and I think it's a good move, good step. I think he'll win the press conference for the Trojans.
No, it sounds – don't know anything about him, you know, but I trust, you know, Coach Curry and the people that were on the selection committee, a lot of very, very smart people that are very tied into Little Rock and know what is needed and have ultimate confidence in them to be able to get the right guy. Sounds like it's off to a good start.
Yeah.
Joe, your thoughts on NCAA tournament, the opening weekend, and where it is now to the Sweet 16?
Can I swear on the radio?
We may be able to get rid of it.
No,
I'm
going to
get on the dump button real quick.
Yeah. I think it's business as usual, you know. What you think you know, you don't know.
Right.
I mean, SEC, we're awesome, man. Yeah. We're getting ready to kick ass and take names, and we got two left.
Two.
You know, so, I mean, I think Big Ten or Big 12 also, they took a hit, I believe. And so, you know, those were kind of the two conferences that everybody was kind of crowing about.
Yeah. And the ACC was down.
Yeah, ACC's not any good. They got one or two teams. They're not anything. And I mean, I think a lot of it has to do with matchups. Obviously it always does, but I mean, the whole thing is if you don't play good, you're losing, you know, or you're going to play a much lesser team and be in a dogfight. And then in the last 5 minutes, you're like Kentucky, you're going to feel pressure you've never felt before because you're looking over there at Oakland and they're like swinging for the fences and you guys are, you know, tighter than a, you know, you know, so I mean, you know, it takes us on this monster and I mean, it rears its head and you know, if you don't play good, you know, you're asking for it. And I think with a lot of the SEC teams, you know, the teams that lost, they did not, you know, Mississippi State scored 51 points. South Carolina uncharacteristically gives up 87.
80-something, yeah.
I mean, you know, Kentucky just was bad.
Couldn't make shots.
Yeah, they were bad. And I mean, and the thing that's been bad about them all year is they couldn't guard. And, again, if you look at your analytics or KenPom usually, if you look at that, teams that advance in this tournament and go deep, they're usually top 25 defense. I mean, they're not top one or two, but they're good. They're strong defensively, and then they have a top 50 offense. I mean, so they can score, but they can stop you if they have to. They can put together two or three stops in a row and get a little momentum going. And you know, the teams that very watched Alabama last
night.
That's
where I was going next. I wanted to talk about the two SEC teams.
And I think I like Tennessee. I think they can win an ugly game because they're going to guard you. The fact that they can also show what they did against Texas, you know, you're sitting there and they're 1-for-21 from the three-point line. You're like, make a shot, man. Mm-hmm. I mean, and they were good looks.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like they, like Wade Taylor and them last night, some of the shots they were taking were like, what are you doing?
Yeah.
I mean, but Kentucky, I mean, Tennessee takes good shots, and they were missing great shots. So you kind of sit there and worry about that. You kind of thought they might be over that to that extent with Connect. You know, you thought – you wouldn't see a 1-for-20. You might see 6-5, mm-hmm. but you wouldn't see that. And so when you see that, you kind of go. But on the positive side of that is,
they won.
They win. They played
terrible offensively.
They played as bad as they could play offensively and beat a good Texas team. So I think that's where you kind of go. Tennessee, I still got to see. You know, I got to see Alabama play some defense against somebody who's a little bigger, a little more athletic. No disrespect to Grand Canyon, but, you know, I want to see it against a bigger
North Carolina team.
Yeah.
Well, I was impressed that Alabama didn't play well offensively, and they relied on their defense and did a good job. And I haven't seen that out of Alabama much this season.
How many points did they score? 60-something? It wasn't
72-63.
Yeah, 72 for them is
61.
Yeah, 72 for them is
bad.
20 points below their
average.
And so you tell me that they score 72, I would be like,
they lost. They gave up 80 and lost.
Yeah, because they give up 80 at a heart. You know, I call them Kentucky Light. Mm-hmm. They're like Wes. They're like the dude in the classroom when you get all your test scores back, and you failed the test, and you saw that only one other guy failed the test, and you look over, and Alabama goes, we had a 58, but Kentucky had a 57. We're not the worst in that. So, and I know it's something that Nate Oates screams about all year long. He's been on top of it all year long, and he said that that's his biggest concern all year long. And like you said, they're getting ready to see if it's finally kicked in, because they're playing a team that can put them up.
I expect that to be back to the Alabama. Yeah. We've seen the SEC where they've put up 80, 90 points, and the other team does too.
And if you'd have told me last night that the A&M Houston game would have been in the 80s, even with overtime, I'd have told you you're out of your mind. I mean, who knows? I thought you had two really good defensive, you know, grinders that I thought if any game was going to be a 68-66 game, mm-hmm. I would have said that one. And, you know, it was totally opposite what I thought.
It's like you said, there can be surprises at any time. And mentioning Kentucky, how do they fix what they have going on? Because Cal has said that they're not going to totally abandon what they've been doing, but they do need to address the problems and there needs to be some change. So what he's saying is, these highly ranked, highly recruited players coming out of high school, he's not going to completely give up on them.
Well, the problem isn't – here's the problem, Joe, and I mean, I love Cal. I mean, played for him. I don't think there's a better coach for Kentucky than him, but he's got to sit down and go, let me tell you what, them playing the defense they played this year, that's on him and his staff. I mean, that's a joke. They were awful. Awful. And I mean, to have that talent – and to have that size and just not to be able to stop anybody, to have a guy shoot, you know, make 10 threes on you, you know, at some point you got to go. Somebody on the team's got to – you got to have some inner pride, and it's got to be demanding. And, you know, if it's happening on the court, it's happening for two reasons. And I've always believed this as a coach. You're either letting it happen or you're coaching it that way. And Cal's not coaching them not to play defense. So the problem is he's getting all these guys in. He's trying to make them all happy. At some point, you got to go, look, man, you ain't playing. McDonald's All-American, NIL. You know, you either start playing some defense or you can sit your butt right over by here and have a great seat the rest of the year. Mm-hmm. That's the way it's going to be. And so I don't like how he has all these bigs. I don't think, again, they're playing a zone. They're playing Oakland. They had, and again, I always look towards the bigs, but, you know, you got Trey Mitchell on Onyemso. I can't never say his name, number 33, Big Z, Trey Mitchell. I mean, they got all these bigs, and they ought to be pounding that thing in there and just, I mean, they were guarding these guys with 6'7 and 6'8 guys, and you got Dillingham and Reeves and Shepherd out there just jacking up threes in half-court situations. I can see it in a break. You know, you get in a break and you can do it, but not even trying to get them to collapse that zone and then kick it out and let these guys get cleaner, better looks, let them play to a guy that's running at them so they can get in the paint and make some things happen. I just think what Kentucky's got to do is they got to coach better.
Yeah.
And they got to be more demanding of their players. And, again, they can talk about the age. 2 years ago he had the oldest team in the league. St. Peter's beat him. This year he had a young team. They get beat by Oakland. The age ain't the problem. You better start coaching some defense and holding some guys accountable, or it's going to be same, you know, SSDD. You know, I mean, it's not going to change.
Joe Klein bringing it on a Monday. More with Joe when we come back, 661-1037. Stick around. It's Out of Bounds.
Slim Chickens of Central Arkansas presents Rollin' with Nolan on Drive Time Sports with Randy Rainwater and Rick Schaefer every Thursday at 6 on 103.7 The Buzz.
This is SportsCenter.
The Sweet 16 in the NCAA tournament is set. It starts back up on Thursday, where we'll have Clemson versus Arizona at 6:09, a rematch on last year's national championship game, UConn versus San Diego State at 6:39, Alabama taking on North Carolina at 8:39, and then in the late game, we'll have Iowa State facing Illinois at 9:09. On Friday, NC State, who's the lowest seed left in the tournament at an 11 seed, will take on Marquette at 6:09. Purdue and Gonzaga will go at it at 6:39. Houston and Duke will face each other at 8:39, and then Creighton and Tennessee will end the night when they tip off at 9:09. And the coaching carousel in college basketball continues. Florida Atlantic's head coach Dusty May is now the head coach at Michigan, while Drake's head coach Darian DeVries made the move to West Virginia. I'm Christian Weaver with the Buzz Radio Network. Tune in each week on Morning Mayhem as Bo Mattingly joins the guys and gives his behind-the-scenes look that he gets from his relationship with the University of Arkansas. Thanks to UAMS Health, the official orthopedics and sports medicine provider for Razorback Athletics. Oaklawn Racing Casino Resort presents Oaklawn Race Day with Justin Akery and David Wanginati every Saturday morning at 11. Oaklawn Race Day is your inside track to America's hottest thoroughbred action and Arkansas' source for racing news and analysis. Oaklawn Race Day, presented by Oaklawn, Arkansas's only racing casino resort.
Hey, it's Matt Zimmerman for Telco Federal Credit Union. Hey, they get it at Telco Federal Credit Union. With rising home loan rates, maybe staying put and just fixing up your current home is a better financial solution. Telco offers home improvement loans even if you have little to no equity. Now you can get your kitchen and bath remodeled and some new flooring. The local team at Telco Credit Union will find you the right loan, the lowest rate, and will make the process so easy. Stop in, log on at telco.com or call 501-375-5321.
If there's anything green in your yard right now, it's probably a weed, and you need to do something about it. Weed control and fertilization service from Sanders Ground Essentials is easier and less expensive than doing nothing or trying to do it yourself. I did that one time and almost killed my yard. Sanders Ground Essentials saves you time and money and makes your yard the envy of the neighborhood. Don't wait. Do it now. Call Sanders Ground Essentials and get started with Sanders Ground Essentials Weed Control Program. Servicing all of Central Arkansas, including West Little Rock and Conway. On the web at sandersground.com. Let's get growing.
Get in the zone, AutoZone.
Welcome to AutoZone. What are you working on today? Brakes? We can save you 15% on that. We have OE quality Duralast brake pads and rotors in stock, ready for pickup or delivery. We also have calipers, brake fluid, tools, and anything else you'll need to do the job right. When you get Duralast pads and rotors together, you'll save 15%. It's just part of what makes us America's number one brakes destination.
Some people just know the best rate for you is a rate based on you with Allstate. Not one based on the driver who treats the highway like a racetrack and the shoulder like a passing lane. Why pay a rate based on anyone else? Get one based on you with DriveWise from Allstate.
Not available in Alaska or California, subject to terms and conditions. Rates are determined by several factors, which vary by state. In some states, participation in DriveWise allows Allstate to use your driving data for purposes of rating. While in some states, your rate could increase with high-risk driving, generally, safer drivers will save with DriveWise. Allstate Fire and Casualty Insurance Company and affiliates, Northbrook, Illinois.
Calling all basketball fans, our season is here. We know that this time of year, traveling fouls can happen anywhere and anytime. That's why All About Tire and Brake Tire Pros is the MVP of tire service and savings. Our expert, certified technicians are the community's number one trusted choice for any tire or service need, with the goal of making sure you're not stuck on the bench. Visit in stores in Mapleville or Little Rock, online at allabouttireandbrake.com. Tire Pros, love the drive.
Join the Zone Thursday for the grand opening of the brand new Lumber One Home Center, complete with Design One, a 34,000 square foot showroom and interior space at 10800 Colonel Glenn Road. Stop in and check it out with 103.7 The Buzz.
Make it the event that everyone wants to attend by getting your meat for tailgates, parties, or just family get-togethers at Hogg's Meat Market. Hogg's Meat Market, the steak people.
Back to Out of Bounds, Wes Moore, Joe Franklin. We got Joe Klein in the studio hanging out, talking the NCAA tournament, Razorback baseball. Got a lot on our plate today. It's a weekend recap brought to you by Fleet Management Services. Got Eddie on hold. Let's bring in Eddie. Eddie, what's going on?
Well, actually, my radio is about 5 seconds behind y'all. It's kind of freaking me out, but I've been around music my whole life. So, anyway, yeah. The speech Joe just gave was so inspiring. I thought everybody would be calling up to say, wow, that was awesome. Am I on the radio right now?
You are on the radio. I just, you know, well, we don't like to give Joe too many compliments.
We're all uncomfortable in here.
Yeah.
Oh, we lost you, Eddie. You went to a bad spot. Thanks for your call. We appreciate you listening to Out of Bounds. When you look at these next matchups, I'm excited about a couple of these. All eight games are good,
yeah,
but,
no.
I mean, Houston-Duke jumps out to me right away.
Yeah, that'll be interesting. I mean, you know, Duke, again, it's Vermont and
James Madison,
which they got a good draw. Mm-hmm. But, again, you know, you would have said Kentucky had a good draw too. So, I mean, you know what I'm saying? So, I mean, they played well. They played really well, and they've handled business like they should. And they're going to play a team that, again, playing Duke always kind of gets the rile out of some guys. And I think that's the type of team that Houston's going to look at and go, you know, we want to be like them. We want to show them. We want to make a statement.
Mm-hmm.
So I think Houston's going to come in there with some nasty. See if Duke can handle it.
You said something earlier this year, and it was back when I was still in the zone. It was early in the season about Clemson. I don't know if you had seen them play, you watched them.
I watched them. I watched them. They lost. I watched them against – I was getting ready for the Alabama game.
Mm-hmm.
I had Alabama, Arkansas State, and they played a week or right before that, so I watched them, and they beat Alabama at Alabama, and I liked them. I mean, I was like, they got the Shefflin kid, and then the Hall kid. They got a nice front line. They got a little point guard that really does a good job. I can't remember his name, but they were a solid team. I mean, they were a formidable team.
Yeah, I've been on Clemson ever since that conversation that we had. Yep. That you liked Clemson, and so I wasn't completely shocked with what they did to Baylor.
I wasn't either.
Can they do it though again against Arizona?
Yeah, now you're getting another, you know, contrasting styles. I mean, Arizona wants to kind of get up and down and get going. They got some pros, a lot of pros. Projected pros on Arizona's team. They got the kid, is it Love Joe from North Carolina?
Yes. Yeah, oh, yeah.
He's Pac-12 player of the year. They can really get up and down and put some points on the board. Clemson doesn't want to, you know, they're not going to walk it up the floor and, you know, try to beat you 52-50, but they don't want to go at the pace that Arizona wants to go. So it'll be interesting to see. And it'll also be, you know, see, you know, they got Clemson's the Hall kid. They got some size. It'll be, and I know Arizona has some good size, good athletic size. It'll be interesting to see if Clemson's bigs can be effective.
Best team remaining in the field outside of UConn.
Ooh. Arizona's good, man. I mean, they got a lot of dudes, and they're kind of hitting a groove. Yeah, I mean, I think they're kind of – I always think they've struggled a little bit in the first couple rounds, the last couple years, and that monkey's kind of off your back now. And so you got to – you're not going to feel the enormity. I think Purdue's kind of in the same boat. I mean, they've kind of got – you know, they've lost early, and they've rolled these first two games. And so now you're kind of – you're not playing with house money, but the enormity of, oh, my gosh, we can't lose again in the first or second round is kind of off their back. So I would – and I like how they're playing, man. The big boy is boarding and being a presence down low that is a problem. And a little bit of an old school approach. They want to kind of go inside out. I would say those two. I think it's still guard play is important, and I like Love a little bit better than Edie, just because the way basketball is played nowadays, it's a guard centric, especially in the NCAA. So. You know, there's Tennessee is nothing to, you know.
Ziegler.
Yeah, nobody's sitting around going, it's happy to see them coming down.
Right.
So, I mean.
What do you think of their matchup with Creighton?
I think that's going to be a good one, man, because Creighton's sleepy. They're Creighton. They play in the Big East, which is not what it used to be. So, you don't – they're not the sexy, you know, Arizona – Big Ten, Big 12, SEC, that kind of thing. But they're solid. They got I can't remember the big kid's name, number 11, that I remember him from last year, 2 years ago in Maui when he absolutely ate Arkansas's lunch. But they play. They got a good inside out, little bit Purdue-ish.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, I don't think they have an Edie. But the big kid, number 11, his name is escaping me right now, forgive me, but he's a presence inside, and they play well around him, very well coached, shooters, athletic, can play fast, can play slow. No, that's going to be a good game.
Dude's going to have to be on his game.
Yeah, you go 1-for-21 against these cats,
yeah.
And, you know.
They'll run you out of the gym.
You know.
The other big guy for Tennessee came in and played really well and then got in foul trouble.
Waka?
Yeah, yeah. Waka.
Yeah, I like him. He's physical. You know, these are guys, Adu, Waka. They had the big kid last year. I can't remember his name, the big white kid. And I remember years ago, 2 or 3 years ago, doing a game over there and looking at those guys. And I was like, why they recruit these dudes?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, they were just big old dudes that were just kind of lumbering around. And just, but, I mean, you can see that they have
developed
them. And they come in, and, man, they are a presence, especially Adu. I mean, two or three years ago, if you'd have told me he's the player he is now, I mean, there's no way. And even the kid last year, the big white kid they had last year, you know, again, when I saw him, they were just – run around, you know, you'd look at him and go, hey, they got 5 fouls with that dude. I mean, he's going to be able to, you know, beat some people up and do some things. But they, you know, they do a great job over there developing these dudes into players. And so, you know, he's got a, you know, they can guard you. They're going to rebound. I mean, and they can win. They can win that's why I like them. They can win a game in the 80s, low 90s.
Mm-hmm.
And they can win a game in the 60s. I mean, they can kind of do it however you want it. So, and I like you said, I love Ziegler. I think Ziegler's a guy that, again, he can run the game and dish it off and get 12 assists, or he can get 27 on you. I mean, he seems like he's just probably as true a point guard, true point guard, as you got in, yeah, in the tournament.
Let's take a call from Rick. Rick, welcome into Out of Bounds.
Wow, this is the first time I've ever talked to Big Joe. He's one of my heroes. I was in Joe. I'm 59, so I know you're a little bit older. But I used to, on the basketball court, as a, I used to try to pretend I was you. Now I was. I know you're not that much older than me.
I'm but 3 years older.
The thing I remember, I know nobody's ever mentioned this before. You remember when contacts first came out?
Oh, yeah.
And you lost so many contacts fighting it and rebounding it.
Oh, I used
it,
to.
It just, I said,
I had like three pairs in every game.
I was but, you know, because, you know, now you don't have to do that. But back then, so I always appreciated the big man from Slater, Missouri. And then I would love, I missed you at Corky's when I was the principal at Bryant. I always wanted to go in there and just eat and just talk to you, but I miss you every time.
I was in there today.
You had kids back in, and I had kids, and you was coaching them. And, you know, I understand raising a family and all that.
Yep.
I try to do a good job myself.
Yep.
Rick,
but I'm telling you, hey, you are, hey.
Enough of the
love
fest.
Oh,
I know. Yeah. That's awesome.
Everybody keep calling in.
Oh, good
Lord.
Got
some great callers today, Joe.
Yeah. Today's the last day for the buffet, right?
Yeah, it's been good. I mean, so look, we're going to talk about it, but it may stick around. It's been good. I mean, it's tonight from 5 to 7, and it's been
a hit.
Yeah, it's been good. I mean, I mean, everybody seems to be happy with it, and so it's got a chance to hang in there. It might make it to the round of, might make it to the Elite Eight.
Oh, good to hear. Corky's West Little Rock Buffet tonight. Stick around. It's Out of Bounds.
Start spring in style, comfort, and power behind the wheel of a brand new 2024 Chevy Silverado. Guatney Chevrolet has interest rates as low as 2.9% for 72 months on Silverado pickup trucks. Spend less money and get more out of your drive at Guatney Chevrolet. Head to 1301 TP White Drive in Jacksonville to take advantage of fantastic interest rates on new Chevy Silverados. Chevrolet, together, let's drive. 2.9% APR for 72 months. Must finance with GM Financial. Some customers may not qualify. Not available with lease and some other offers. Take new retail delivery by April 30th, 2024.
For Pulaski County residents and businesses, do recycling right by recycling old electronic equipment. How? Come to North Little Rock Simmons Bank Arena parking lot on Tuesday, April 2nd or Wednesday, April 3rd for an electronic recycling event. Learn more at recyclingunplugged.com. If it's electronic and no longer usable, drop it off and we'll recycle it for free. For information, go to recyclingunplugged.com.
Ulta Beauty's semi-annual beauty event is happening now. Unleash your love for beauty with 50% off daily beauty steals on hair, skin, makeup, and fragrance. Shop your favorite brands like Tarte and Fenty Beauty by Rihanna. Plus, grab perfect hair care pairs from brands like Redken and Olaplex. And check out new arrivals from brands like Charlotte Tilbury and Dyson. Shop the Ulta Beauty semi-annual beauty event online, in-store, or try pickup today. Now through March 28th. Ulta Beauty, the possibilities are beautiful. Conditions apply.
Get the one and done you want for your dog's monthly protection. NexGard Plus, a Foxaloner Moxidectin and Pyrantel chewable tablets, protects against fleas, ticks, heartworm disease, roundworms, and hookworms, all in one delicious beef-flavored soft chew. Use with caution in dogs with a history of seizures or neurologic disorders. Dogs should be tested for existing heartworm infection prior to starting a preventive. Ask your vet about NexGard Plus Chews.
If
you're looking for a safe and loving home for you or your loved one, visit Heartland Rehabilitation and Care Center. Just 15 minutes from Little Rock and Benton, our skilled nursing staff is dedicated to providing quality long-term care and short-term therapy. Visit HeartlandRehabCenter.com. You can call Heartland home.
Razorback pitcher Will McIntyre joins Morning Mayhem each week, presented by Seth Boyd with Shelter Insurance. Give Seth a call for all your insurance needs at 501-982-6465.
To thank you for 40 unforgettable years, Dell Technologies is celebrating with anniversary savings on their most popular tech. For a limited time only, save on select next-gen PCs, like the XPS 13 Plus, powered by Intel Core processors, and more. Plus, curate your dream setup with great deals on select monitors, mice, and more must-have electronics and accessories. When you shop online at Dell.com/deals, you'll have access to leading-edge technology and free shipping on everything. Again, that's Dell.com/deals.
Little help? O'Reilly Auto Parts can help. Need advice? We've got advice. No matter what you need, we have thousands of professional parts people doing their part to make sure you have it. Exceptional customer service. Just one part that makes O'Reilly stand apart. The professional parts people.
Oh, 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 O'Reilly Auto Parts.
A motorcycle seems pretty simple. It has one engine, two wheels, and plenty of attitude. But you crash one of these babies, and things get complicated quick. That's when you need these guys.
At Rainwater Holton Sexton, we keep it simple. When the insurance company tries to pay you less, we fight to get you more.
No hassle, no confusing legal terms, and no fee unless we get money for you.
Keep it simple. Call Rainwater, Holt, and Sexton. Motorcycle crash? Anywhere in the state, dial 888-8888.
Non-lawyer spokesperson. Responsible attorneys Michael Rainwater, Bob Sexton.
Get only the best customer service and the best selection of meats at Hogg's Meat Market, where they have sliced boar head deli meats and cheeses. Hogg's Meat Market, the steak people. In Sports is brought to you by Arkansas's own West Rock Coffee. Join West Rock Coffee, the Razorbacks, and their 1.5 million farmers around the globe. It's fall, so now it's time for your team to stock up on coffee, tea, and water delivered directly to your business. Contact them at westrockcoffee.com or 833-886-JAVA today.
Here's something that's trending, but it's not something good. Razorback fans won't like this and don't like this, but the defensive lineman from East Arkansas, Carius Kern, has decommitted from Arkansas. The number one player in the state, big defensive lineman, maybe an offensive lineman. He was so talented on both sides, they didn't know what they were recruiting as a defensive lineman, but some were recruiting him as an offensive
Where's
lineman.
Where's he
from? Marion, I want to say.
Is he a senior next year?
Yeah, he'll be a senior next year. Maybe they can still get him to come, but he is decommitted this afternoon. Ouch. Don't like to see that. NFL's getting ready for the draft. Jim Harbaugh, as you would expect, is very high on J.J. McCarthy, his quarterback in Michigan.
He's incredible. So big market, small market, it wouldn't. Cold weather, hot weather, you know, it won't matter. And I said it before, I think it's well documented. I think he's the best quarterback in the draft. And that's just what I think, just my opinion. He's the one who plays quarterback, you know, of all the quarterbacks that are in the draft. There's great quarterbacks in the draft. I think he plays quarterback the best of any quarterback in the draft.
So the Chargers going to trade Herbert and draft him?
That's what everybody's trying to put together, but no, that's not happening. Now, Deion Sanders, Coach Prime, he had a different take because he was asked about Shador, Travis Hunter.
Are they in the draft?
No, not this year, but just Yeah, thinking about next year. So he was asked about their prospects for next year.
Where do you predict Shador and Travis going in the draft?
Top four.
That's pretty beautiful.
Anywhere from one through four. One of them is going to be one.
That's what I'm talking about.
One of them is going to be
speaking into existence.
And the latter one would not go behind four. Now, all this is subjective because I know where I want them to go.
Mm-hmm.
And let's not forget Shallow, okay?
Mm-hmm.
But I know where I want them to go. So there's certain cities that ain't going to happen. It's going to be an Eli.
So think about what Jim Harbaugh said about J.J. McCarthy. This guy can play anywhere.
Uh-huh.
And then Coach Prime, on the other hand, saying for his son, Travis Hunter, when they're in there next year, his sons, they're going to be places they try to stay away from.
NFL has ruled. I guess the committee got together. The hip drop tackle is out. Not going to do that anymore. Created a lot of injuries. I think unnecessary injuries. Football is a game of injuries. Like Joe said, you're going to get hurt playing football. Take it out. Adjust, Joe. Just adjust. Find a different way to tackle.
Another strike against the defense.
Yeah,
let's get more offense in the game.
No, just get flags.
Here's Pat McAfee.
Guys on the offense now are going to start.
Oh, yeah.
Didn't even think about guys with the ball
flopping
in that competition committee. Did we, Rich McKay, who we're probably going to see tomorrow? Did we think about that where guys are going to be taught probably, hey, we can't say this in drills and we can't be doing this, but, you know, you can tackle from the side or behind. You just kind of go ahead and throw
back.
And the name of safety with brand new rule, we're going to get it. This is just a dumb decision. And this is just like the fair catch thing that happened with kickoffs last year, where all the people that are around football are like, if they do this, what else will they do? If they do this, what else will they do? If you take away tackling somebody from the side, what else are they going to take away? J.J. Watt said, why don't you just go ahead and put the belt on now?
Yep.
Start putting the flags on. Why don't you just go ahead and do the two-hand touch right now? Why don't we put paint on everybody's hands so we can see if we get two hands on everybody? Why don't we stop tackling? Why don't we stop violence? Why don't we stop football being football because of this? I know the stats and analytics people are going to take a victory lap because they were the ones that are pissed off about the hip drop tackle they even block, existing guys. In the first place.
Of course.
But now that there's actually a rule about it, this is going to call for so many questions. There's going to be so many, oh, he can't tackle anybody. That is going to happen.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Every single big game. And let one of these doofus refs, not that all of them are. We're not saying that.
They're not all not doofuses, though.
Bingo. Now we got more judgment by the refs. Yes. What do we even do? It doesn't make any sense. Everybody seems to be pissed and for good reason.
I think it's overreaction. It's not that big of a deal.
It will be to begin the season until they do make the adjustments, until the players do adjust.
Just don't drag him down from behind and then throw your hips forward and legs forward and land on his legs and knees and tear up his ankles and knees. It's pretty simple.
Well, it's not even that you're going to land on him. They're looking at intent. They're going to say, if you tackle a certain way, then it's going to be a penalty. Even if you don't land on somebody with your body weight.
I got a headache.
What, you needed more people calling in telling you how great you are?
Yeah, there's not enough calls for me. Love for Corky's and Joe. That's what this hour, when we talked about this, Joe and Wes, that's what, okay, y'all need to.
We'll step it up.
Need to step it up more. I mean,
we got two calls. Gosh, I didn't know we had to have three or four. Fun day. Thank you, Joe.
You bet, guys. Have a good day.
Yeah. Corky's tonight. Yep. West Little Rock Buffet. Yep. Take advantage of it.
Call us, man. We got anything you need. Delivery, shrimp, catfish. Friday in Lent. Last Friday in Lent.
Yeah.
Come sit. Come get some good catfish, shrimp.
Good games Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Got
load
TVs.
Up.
Got TVs, beer, catfish, and shrimp. What more do you need?
Basketball. See ya. Drive Time's next.